I appreciate everything you do for the benefit of my children. The reason I'm here tonight is just a little bit about the Innovation Zone building, which I know is in its very initial stages. But I guess I just wanted to speak a little bit on the fact of, when I received the survey, I couldn't agree more with all the things that it wants to accomplish in regards to the practices, from, you know, project-based learning to the whole child, to authentic learning environments, from assessments to partnerships. I couldn't agree more with all of it. The thing that I would like to stress is, I really think that's crucial to support in every one of the institutions that we have. And so not just one building. And I read in there that, you know, it might be from a practice standpoint and then putting it into the other building. So I look at it like a pilot, maybe I hear. What I would like to stress is, I would just love to see you guys reflect and really think long and hard about the resources and the funding from the standpoint of what could go towards all the current infrastructures of all the grades, towards supporting all those things that I truly believe in, that you said in the Innovation Zone building, and ensuring that we have the support in all our current buildings to support our administration in those buildings to remove barriers and enhance all those areas, and towards ensuring that happens with all of our classroom teachers. So I just want to make sure that it just doesn't happen in a building, that it happens in all the buildings. And I understand that we have a great quality staff with quality administrators and quality teachers. But I just want to make sure that with the resources and funding, and everyone knows that funding's an issue, let's be quite frank, and with the passing of the recent operational budget, I just would like to make sure that those dollars are going toward our current infrastructures too, and supporting all of those initiatives and approaches, because I think all of it's probably about personalized learning, in my essence of what I got out of the reading, which is putting the individual child at the center of a whole learning process. And I get it, I totally get it, and I respect it, and I support it 110%, but I support it in all of the buildings. And I don't think it just needs to be a building that starts with an Innovation Zone for that to occur. So that's all I want to say. Thanks.
Thank you.
Yes.
Chris, are you guys doing any focused of that project-based learning or projects in your district?
We are. And project-based learning, I think a lot of people look at it from a standpoint, it's an approach or initiative. But that's where I'm going with here. I just want you guys to really think long and hard about project-based learning isn't like in its own isolation. It's about supporting personalized learning. It's one way of supporting personalized learning, along with, it's a quality way of bringing forth authentic assessments, you know, and that, and so I would just like to see any support to the buildings and to the classroom teachers. Personalized learning environments are very difficult and very hard, but they're gonna need support and the resources to really provide that, which means support and resources on the technology side, you know, the one-to-one. I'm ecstatic to hear about it coming. I can't wait. And I think they need a lot of support and resources on professional development and all of those things. So again, I'm a firm believer that it's not necessarily a building. I'm not saying that the Innovation Zone's not, I love it, the discussion's there. I just don't want to see a lot of resources and funding go to one area when I really think those resources and funding need to be supported throughout the whole district for it to occur adequately.
All right, thank you.
And I was just, do you have any specialized professional development that you've done in that area in your district?
Well, I don't know if I've specialized in anything. we have some.
We specialize enough to hire our own kids out from under us.
Yeah,
thank you very much.
You're welcome on that.
Thank you.
Yeah, we have some resources on it.
Okay. So maybe we could resource on that.
Yeah, thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, next we have Laura Pabrocki.
Hello. I'm Laura Pabrocki, and my husband and I and our two children are residents of Monona. We have a third grader and a 4K daughter. And I'm talking about the charter school. And when I first found out about it, it was word of mouth, and then the survey. And it piqued my interest immediately. And the parts that caught my attention first was an educational atmosphere that included more time in nature, kids being active, project-based, and multi-age. I see how much energy our children have and how much they want to move naturally. And I see how our family is happiest by far and stress-free when we're in nature. It's one of our best places to be together as a family. And I see that our children thrive when they can connect with the natural world, which is really hard to do when you're sitting at a desk, okay? And I understand that the charter school is by no means gonna revolve around completely around being in nature. I just find it to be a really important part, considering all the research that's been also going into the fact that it's not just kids that need to be in nature, us adults need to be as well. And so when I came to the school board meeting on August 24th and I learned more about all the research that had gone into the process and how many people were involved in the committee and the commitment that they had, I was impressed. I mean, for the most part, I understand that was voluntary, for the most part. And that's fairly impressive to have. Let's see, as I understand it, there were some educators in that group, administrators, parents, community members. And the overwhelming sense that I got hearing about what they had to share was that they were all pretty excited and wanted to move forward. And years ago, I was involved in potentially starting a charter school in the Madison area. And I can say that after, you know, the same amount of time, there were, you know, the group wasn't all excited. So to have a group that has done some significant research and to come to the point where they all are still in support of moving forward, that's key. You know, that's a key element that I heard. And then when I heard about the Eldo Leopold connection and their commitment to support an effort like this, I kind of just felt like slam dunk. This could really work. This is just across the street. And from what I understand, this would be the facility that this charter school could use. And that's another aspect that I just wanted to voice that, you know, I don't know how much of this building right now is utilized, okay? But I'm an engineer and I understand that whether a small part is being used or the whole building is being used, it still takes money to heat it and to cool it and to run it and to operate it. And so to know that our district already has a facility that could hold this charter school is pretty phenomenal. I mean, that's also a key point that I just wanted to bring up that I did not know and find supportive. And after that school board meeting, I had some time to think about everything that I had heard. And the one word that keeps coming up for me is innovation. It requires risk in order to get to a new place. And we cannot keep improving by doing the same things that we have done. And just to reiterate what the fellow said before me, of course, this does not have to be in one facility. I mean, this could be happening in other schools. However, to have a concentrated effort in what I would call an incubator space, where the district could have a go at this. And I feel as though no matter what eventually comes of the charter school, that no effort is going to be a waste, okay? Even the research that was done. And so moving forward, I feel as though the district would be able to kind of skim the cream off the top, if you will, and share the things that have worked, that would work well in this incubator with the entire district. So everybody would benefit. You know, our kids are young, but everything I hear, particularly from being an engineer, is innovation, innovation. We have to innovate, whether that's in a business setting or in an educational setting. Our kids are in a position where they are taught to think outside of the box. They're told to be creative, to draw outside the lines, to be innovative. And we know moving forward that we are going to need innovators to to move forward, to successfully continue forward, to take care of the earth and the world and our economy. And so I just wanted to share that true leadership feels really uncomfortable, and it's uncharted territory, and it's scary. And I can imagine that all of you may feel all of those things, being the people that make the decision as to whether this moves forward. However, given the pieces of the puzzle that you already have, which is an incredibly excited committee, an available facility, the Elder Leopold connection, I can think of no better way to forge forward. So thank you for your time.
Thank you, Laura.
Thank you.
Questions? Good. All right, thank you very much. Moving on to the consent agenda. I'd like a motion for approval of the consent agenda as presented.
A motion to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
So moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. And me, recognitions?
I'd like to begin with one, and this is one that I think the board is aware, but we did not get an opportunity to publicly recognize yet. One of our outstanding teachers, Juan Batea, who spent this week in Washington, D.C. to receive the President Award for Excellence in Mathematics and Science teaching. There's information in your board packet in terms of details, but again, this is something, of course, extremely proud to have Juan on our staff, and a well-deserved recognition on his part as well. So, again, congratulations, Juan.
How many are chosen nationally every year?
I don't know the exact number. I did look at it, and it was approximately, what I could see, about two per state, so I think about 100.
Yeah, it's two per state plus the territory, so it's like 107.
Thank you.
I just looked because I was curious because I saw the 107. I thought, what? And it was because they included
Okay.
So, yeah.
Okay.
But it's out of a lot more. I mean, hundreds of applicants.
There are.
It's a very, very competitive award. So, yeah.
So there are a number of Wisconsin educators that get it awarded at the state level, and then only those few that are national.
Susan, did you have something?
I just wanted to mention that I am so proud that in our new teacher group, we have at least three Monona Grove High School grads in that group. And one of them actually has such incredible science background. And she comes from the history of the integrated science program prior to biology, chemistry, and physics. And now has really specialized in science and been teaching in science quite a few years. So it was really interesting to have a conversation with her about what she'd like to do and what her expectations are and being able to do hands-on projects. And then I was, so that's really neat. And I think, and sorry that, and we should be proud as well that one of our MG grads is going to be a principal for Superintendent Hibner, which is also kind of exciting. But it's just fun to have them want to come back to this location and to teach. And so I just want, and the other thing that's really neat is I had a parent stop me tonight and say, thank you, which, as Chris said, we do not rarely, if ever. And his son is taking AP Physics. So thank you. And he's excited about it.
Any else?
I have a couple.
Yeah.
I would just like to congratulate Jana Ulrich, a teacher at our school, Glacier Drumlin, for obtaining the anemic grant Donors Choose grant. That is called Loving Life and Learning in the Middle School. And she has written for several different types of supplemental materials and has received those. Not a large amount of money, but nonetheless a good effort on her part. And also Valerie McCarthy, who is a reading teacher at our school, and she has received a $100 grant through MEMIC for supplemental reading materials and reading.
Thank you.
Did she get that through the Cole thing, the Herb Cole thing?
Pardon?
Did she get that through the Herb Cole thing, the Donors Choose?
Yes, Donors Choose is through Herb Cole.
Right.
Yeah.
Cool. Okay.
One. Just a quick update, and I know Carrie will report on that probably at the next meeting, but the Education Foundation has received a substantial contribution from an MG grad, and they'll be talking about that later. And then in relation to the gala, again, November 5th, it should be on all your calendars, and hopefully you're all going to be there. But in approximately 10 days, they received almost $5,000 in sponsorships, which is amazing. Several of those from MG grads or families who had MG students. So again, I think it speaks very highly of what you're doing here, and we should be proud. Thank you, Stephen Klinke, and Monona State Bank. And
Item F, correspondence and announcements.
Nothing to do.
The only one that I had to add is maybe to elaborate on what Susan just mentioned. We don't have an official board report tonight from the Monona Grove Education Foundation because I just met this morning. So Joyce had the grace period for me of having to prep a report, but I actually do have my notes still handy. And the most important thing from this morning, and what just a tremendous gift, Richard Brandt, who is a Monona Grove grad from 1961, has made arrangements to give $50,000 to the Monona Grove Education Foundation as part of his estate planning and something that he had to withdraw from an account and chose us as the beneficiaries. And there's a whole lot more detail forthcoming when that gift is announced in the media. But very exciting morning meeting, great way to start the day. And I mean, I'd be happy to provide more information, but not maybe right at this minute, but it's fantastic.
Is that an immediate cash grant, or is it?
His intent is for it to be spent and not to be used as an endowment. So that was how the discussion was handled this morning. And he lives in California, but he was physically present at the meeting this morning because he was in town. He told us that he was in town for the 55th reunion of his class, which was just happening within the past few days. Just really fun to meet him in person and to know that this was such a significant experience. Here, his high school degree from MG made a real difference to him, and of course his family was involved. He talked about his father and his role in starting the district. There's lots more detail that'd be super fun to talk about, but totally inappropriate now to go on at length, but really wanted to make sure that people knew what a great gift that was. We just got it today.
Thank you.
I'll just add one more tidbit. Tomorrow I have the pleasure of meeting with Mr. Brandt to give him a tour of MG21 in our high school as well. He's very much looking forward to that.
Yes.
All right. MG, administrative reports, starting with Dan.
Okay, just one item, and we probably just got posted today, but we wanted to give you a preliminary enrollment report. Of course, our official third Friday count is coming up at the end of the week, and our next board meeting you'll have a much more detailed report. But just to let you know where we're at with enrollment, and this is, these are not numbers we verified and went through with principals. We just simply ran the report from Infinite Campus. And so it gives you a good idea about where we're at. And you might wonder how these numbers change. Well, we do have, with 3,400 students in the district, there are number of students that move in and out on a regular basis, even a week after school starts, believe it or not, that still happens. And so 2 points that I'd like you to look at in that report, you have a hard copy in front of you as well. The next to last column, the projected enrollment, those are the numbers that we used in January after the second Friday January count that we were using to base our open enrollment allotment for, and basically when we did our staffing plan at that point to look at potential class sizes and so on. And so you see the actual enrollment as of yesterday, in some cases varied quite a bit. Now, what we didn't include on here was the actual enrollment the last day of school. That also was quite different than the January, by quite meaning, by about 20 students, variance. And so you might wonder, how can we be so off in our projections? Well, part of it was those numbers had already changed by the end of the school year, and then it's really attributed to students moving in and out of the district. So you look at overall, it's slightly less than what we used as projections. But keep in mind, when we project, we're trying to be accurate, but we're also trying to be a little bit safe. When we have to determine open enrollment numbers, we want to make sure we reserve seats for potential move-ins so we don't have overcrowding as far as class sizes. And in some cases, we did project a little bit high in that. The place where we projected too low was Glacial Drumwood School. We had a large number of move-ins late in the summer, and so you'll see at Glacial Drumwood. On this report, we come in 922, and I checked with Renee, she had 916. We'll get that reconciled, but nonetheless, it's still about 20 higher than what we had in our initial projection, and it's all attributed to move-ins. In particular, sixth grade was the one class where we had concerns about approaching maximum class sizes per board policy. And so when scheduling was completed to start the school year, we have nine sections of sixth grade. And so with teachers teaching five sections each, 45 sections, we had five of those 45 that had class sizes of 27. Our board policy states that our range should max out at 26. And so we had a choice. We could reconcile those by moving students. We try to keep them within their you know, groups. Weighing that class size versus, you know, moving students, and determined the best thing was to actually make some adjustments and change sections. So we do now have all classes at 26 or less in sixth grade, which is, you know, consistent with board policy. Everywhere else, we're within the ranges as we expected. So you can read the numbers as well as I won't repeat them, but we'll give the detailed report next meeting, and then looking ahead, certainly this is going to be a topic for the board to consider, is, you know, updating our enrollment projections with our long-range facilities and so on.
Any questions, Susan?
Well, so Dan, we can't see these numbers right now because we don't have the breakdowns,
right?
Okay, you're just kind of giving us an update?
Correct.
Because it looks like at Glacial Drumwood that the sixth grade is almost 40 less than it was last year, but 274.
Okay, I'm comparing to the next to last column, which was our projected enrollment.
Right.
So 220 was our projection, and we ended up with 236.
Because last year,
but we had two.
Last year, sixth grade is now seventh grade.
Right, but we would have staffed that for that number of students, and then you staffed it for the 220. So
correct.
We were 15.
Yeah, you wouldn't staff it.
Yeah, exactly.
So actually, last year, you have to look at fifth grade last year. There was 216 kids in fifth grade last year. This year, once we're at 236, so we had over 20 new students moving to that sixth grade class. So we staffed it at the 220 or at that goal, but we were using the projection of 220 based on last year having 215 kids in that fifth grade that rolled up. We obviously staff at the goal for the purposes of if we miss or if we have a large increase, which this year we had even a larger increase than we typically do. But if you look at the bottom, which I think is interesting, at the end of last school year, we had 3,426 students. Right now, we're only at 3,458. We really saw an increase in one specific grade. When you look at Taylor Prairie, we're, you know, actually down by 18 students from where we were the year before. Only up a couple at Cottage Grove, only up about 10 at Winnequa, and the high school has pretty much maintained.
So when we see that we're 16 over what we projected, that's a section almost. So are we going to reconsider? We're going to evaluate that?
We have, and we're able to within the goals. Remember that number, that 220, you know, when you divide that out, that still gives you leeway. We were under the maximum at the 220.
Okay,
how we
so
staffed
what are
it.
Those sections right now?
So we the mac they vary because of the, you know, we have different students taking different math and so on. So they vary from the low 20s.
But the sixth grade is still generally still assigned to one versus the seventh and eighth. Generally, there's unless that's changed.
Yeah, they all have different numbers.
And they all basically the only place that kind of changes.
And so you like to explain how sixth grade sections work?
What was your question?
So when you assign your sections to sixth grade, or maybe we'll just talk about that when you do the sections next time, but what I'm looking for is the process when it's clear that we're not, so if we have nine sections, or at least one over something, I don't know what that is.
So last spring when we were staffing, we were at about under 24 per class.
Okay.
And we did have an increase of 26 students in sixth grade. And so, yeah, we had a couple classes in this. If you look at our homerooms, where you're looking at, you know, without looking at advanced math and some of those classes that end up skewing the numbers in the other classes, we are just at 26, just under 26 in all the homeroom classes.
And our goal for sixth grade is?
Is 26.
The max is 26, yeah, the goal is 24.
The goal is 24.
The goal is 24, okay. That's why I'm asking for the right number, thank you. So it's 24, so we're two over?
Over the goal, but within the guidelines.
I'm asking, Renee.
The maximum is 26, and that's what it is at fifth grade too. We actually have one class that is at 26 in fifth grade. So.
But the goal is the goal, because that's what we still aim for, and that's why we keep that number there, correct?
Correct.
Okay.
You know, in the time I've been in Glacial Drumlin, I think that it's been pretty common to be at the maximum in some of our grade levels. And the same thing with the seventh and eighth grade, which has a class size maximum of 30. You know, I think we have really tried our best to staff it at a lower level, and we added sections. We have a bubble moving through. That was last year in sixth grade. Seventh grade has 11 sections, and eighth grade has 10. The bigger issue for us, to me, is not class size, but the building and the needs of the building and the space in the building. Class size is definitely something we have to consider, but I honestly, we've converted to computer labs for this year, and we're gonna have to continue to convert space if we have the type of growth that we've seen this year. And I'm really not sure where else we're going to convert the space. So I do think that's something that has to be discussed and should be on the front burner.
Okay.
That's exactly where I was going to in my head. Thank you for bringing that up. Actually, the numbers that we looked at a couple years ago, I still sort of keep with me the numbers when we looked at our long-range facilities planning and the concerns that we had even at that time about are the schools at capacity or what, using the different types of ways of projecting maximum capacity, how close were we on those different measures? And so that was May of 2015. So if we were looking at the numbers at that time of 867 students at the end of that year at Glacial Drumlin, we were told then that there was room for 33 to 79 additional students, I mean, so ballparking it, maybe up to 75 or 80 students. The growth that we've had then from that time to now, if we use a 922 number today, is 55 students. So it's starting to make me really nervous about Glacial Drumlin just being really pushing the capacity of that building and being uncomfortable. In addition to all the class size stuff that you know I already care about, but how is the building feeling this year at 55 more students than at the end of 2014-15?
With middle school bodies, it feels crowded.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it does, and teachers will tell you that as well. I mean, we're managing it, but anybody who lives in a building where they've experienced that knows that it's, you know, it's just that much more to manage, the transitions in the hallway, really working with the students, making sure we're all out there acting as road bumps for the students, you know, in the middle of the hallway, speed bumps, so that they're not, you know, able to run each other over. And just thinking to the future, if we continue to see this kind of growth for next year, I see the projections, which are always under. You know, it says 922 for next year. So does that mean we'll really be at 950? I'm very concerned about it and feel that, you know, it needs to be something that's discussed and prioritized as far as what we're going to do to deal with that.
I'm super eager to get back to those conversations. So thank you for that tonight and, you know, how I feel about it. So I've got to stay on this.
Yeah.
Did we solve the locker problem?
Yes, the locker problem is being resolved. Jeff has been working on that. We do have lockers that are being ordered. We have a place that for them to be. They're not there yet. And that's going to take time, like 6 weeks. So it's not going to be resolved immediately for that one fifth grade class that doesn't have lockers.
Right. So were we 22 short? Or were we more than
that?
Yes,
a whole class.
So we were that one whole class short, okay.
Mm-hmm. And we decided internally to really just concentrate that in one fifth grade class instead of spreading it out throughout the building.
Dean?
Is the crowding there, the size of the classroom when you begin to push the numbers up, or is it the whole building or both?
It's both. It's definitely hallway transitions.
Well, we've talked sometimes about having the fifth grade out of there.
Yes.
How would that solve all the problems?
Well, we would have about 150 fewer students, so it would relieve the pressure. And that's what I think we need. It's not going to be a long-term fix, but we do have to start thinking about short-term.
Sounds like the square footage of the classroom is an issue.
Just, I think, again, I'm kind of back to the whole building. Mm-hmm. I feel like we've done a pretty good job with our class sizes, without, you know, with some exceptions here and there, because we've converted space. But I'm just concerned about the building in general and the space in the building. If we end up adding more students next year, these are all residents that have come into the district. And by the way, they're not all coming to Cottage Grove and the big houses out in Cottage Grove that are being built around the school. Lynn Nelson ran it, and there are about equal numbers in Monona and Cottage Grove. And don't know, but speculation is that people are also moving into apartments. Mm-hmm. And that was something else that came up in our facility study. You know, so I think it's important to analyze it so we know exactly what the situation is, and we're not just assuming that it's, you know, the housing in Cottage Grove that people are moving into.
With the class sizes out there, are they closer to 700 square feet or 900?
I don't know.
We can.
That makes a difference. Well,
we're going to have the enrollment report come back after the third Friday count at our next meeting, and we can leave more time.
Okay. So I'll expect the square footage of classrooms on the
right. And we'll have more details at a time for us to look at.
That's actually in your building report of the committee you chair.
Got it.
It's a great report.
Thank you.
I know, I don't have it here, though.
I don't either. I appreciate it.
Next up is the.
Peter, I have one more question for Renee. When we talk about that, would you also, understanding that we didn't really schedule that time for tonight, but again, knowing this board is interested in where you are and what mm-hmm. the space was. Remember, we had this discussion 7 years ago about, you said, oh, we got space. And I said, I bet you don't. But talking about the lunch hour, too. So how many lunch hours are you having to run right now?
We have four.
Mm-hmm.
And it's actually working pretty well this
year. Okay. Well, that's because you
right.
make it work. Thank you.
We have the capital projects update from Jeff and Jerry.
Yep. So I'll ask Jeff to come up and walk through this. What was attached to the board? That was with the original, what was approved.
Mm-hmm.
And then in front of you, and also attached, we were able to take that document, actually add where actual cost came in, and I will let Jeff walk through that. And we do have two outstanding projects that we did not get completed, and he'll be able to address those.
Right. Thank you. Everything went very well and in a timely manner, working around summer school and working with contractors that were all but two projects on time. The two projects that are held up are, you can see, will occur. And when I say October, the reason of being October is because that's when the institute days is, that they can get in and do the work. It has to do with, there's some bathroom partition replacements at the high school down on the three floors, just off of the commons, but then, as I said, on all three floors. And then some windows at Taylor Prairie. Those were shipped on time, but when they opened up the crates, they were all damaged. So they all had to go back and be rebuilt. So everything else went very well, and you can see that we came in under budget. We were able to get some better pricing on some of the things. And remember, overall, the projects that we did this summer were pretty much fill-in projects that we haven't got into the facility plan work. We will start on that meeting with the principals and their staffs here in October and reviewing the, there was three categories in there, immediate needs, 3 to 5 years, and then 5 to 10 years. So we'll evaluate that again. Then we'll sit down with the architects and C.G. Schmidt and look at that to start putting some pricing together so we can get some budgeting together with Jared, and then work on what the bid packages and things would be. So we'll start that process, like I said, next month. Any questions on any of these things?
Dean?
Are projects on this list, were they on the C.G. Schmidt Longhorn Facility maintenance? Are they on there?
There's a couple odds and ends ones, but the C.G. Schmidt was a bigger scope of work. Okay. These were things that when we started looking at this last year, we were at a point that a lot of that hadn't been finalized. So these are things that we picked up, you know, going with a $300,000 budget, which had been used in the past for capital projects, and trying to, I don't want to say fill a void, but with what's on the C.G. Schmidt project list, you're looking at, you know, more extensive work as far as, you know, putting bid documents together and, you know, drawings and all those things, and trying to then look at lumping those into categories so you're going to get better pricing on your bidding. That timing did not line up. So there's a few things on here, but I will honestly tell you, we have not really got into that C.G. Schmidt plan to be able to make a large dent into that. And I think that goes also with the timing of when you're going to have your referendum money.
Is that, you know, is this, is some of this, we had a commitment in the referendum. I forget what the amount was in that category exactly, but it would be good perhaps when we deal with all these kind of categories, particularly this one, I think it would be good to show how we have maintained some faith or some reason why we haven't on the budgetary commitment. I think that maintenance includes C.G. Schmidt and other
yes.
stuff, right?
Yep, so definitely we discussed at the annual meeting and budget hearing to show where the budget was
okay.
going. And as we were working through this with the referendum being in April, the timing wasn't right, so that's where we put additional funding into the technology to upgrade our wireless and our switching. And so that money was, so it's really back to facilities by upgrading our infrastructure for technology. And then we'll move back into the items that were outlined by C.G. Schmidt through that long-range facility plan.
Well, if you're suggesting that the annual meeting, that the referendum commitment, it would, I think that would be a good sidebar for to discuss to what extent we're able to keep faith with that, we're exceeding what we're saying, or if we're behind some of it. And I know those were rough estimates to begin with, but it'd be good to explain it in those terms as well, I would think.
Gary?
I just have two things, Jeff. First of all, thank
sure.
you for staying on these projects. The ones that I'm most anxious about are the ones that you already alluded to are coming up this year, the ones that they said were urgent when we got that into like 14, 15.
Correct.
So now those just feel ultra urgent to me. So thank you for staying with us. And the second thing is, I didn't know if you've gotten this feedback yet, but the fourth graders at Cottage Grove School are super excited about the bottle fill station.
Yes.
I hope you're hearing that good feedback too, because that's all I heard about that.
Thanks. You know, for something, I want to say minimal,
mm-hmm.
that hand dryers are the biggest thing that I'm getting the comments on of how great those things are. And, you know, for what that consisted of. And, you know, when I talked to the principals, I was kind of introduced this, and they're like, oh, yeah, I think that'll go over real well. So then we started getting pricing on it. We were able to actually get better pricing with the more we got. So I said, all right, we're going to take care of every building. Somebody's going to get a piece of the pie here. And that all worked out, and everybody's really happy about that. So, and honestly, like, you know, when you're talking, Dean, a little bit about upgrading some things, something as small as a drinking fountain is, you know, really big to everybody on a day-to-day basis. And we've got drinking fountains that, you know, are original within these buildings that, you know, the water flow isn't good. You know, some of them are the old ceramic ones that have no chilled water to them. And plus, like you're saying, a lot of people use the bottles now, and, you know, trying to fill those things up and all that, and ends up on the floor and that. So, you know, it was kind of a minor thing, but boy, it went over, you know, like one of the greatest things we ever did.
Did you grow up in Wisconsin?
Did I grow up in Wisconsin? No, but my parents did.
That's why it's not a bubbler. We're talking our language.
Any other questions on any of this?
I have a couple. One, I was interested in your feedback on the hand blowers, particularly in the elementary levels. They're starting, and it's very new. It's very new, and the numbers are just really, you know, still incredibly variable. But because of the noise of the blowers, kids are not washing their hands.
Oh, I talked.
If you go into an airport, and there are three little children in there, and somebody puts their blower on, they cover their ears and walk out. So I'm just mildly concerned. One of the things I think we could do to remedy that, if we start to see that or hear that, is to use the Santa drip, you know, some kind of Santa drip that they can still clean their hands. Mm-hmm. But, and again, the research is still so new because they're just putting them in. And then they're gonna start tracking bacterial infections and things like
sure.
that. But you don't have any feedback on that?
No, other than, all the principals were involved. So when, like today I talked to Connie and she brought that up about, you know, some of the kids. But the one that was put in there, and the kind of intent was a lot of these, was to put them in where we have large groups, you know, your commons area. So when you've got outside groups coming in and you may not have a custodian working, that you don't have to worry about running out of paper towels or, you know, those kind of things. Also, you'll notice too that we've gone through and we redid all our dispensers for paper towels and toilet paper. We go with the bigger rolls now, we're getting better pricing on that, and then also it's gonna serve the purpose as far as, you know, being more accessible, people not running out and those things. But with the hand dryers, they were put in those areas where, you know, you have large outside groups coming in and using our schools, so we don't have to worry about, you know, people running out of towels or whatever. So honestly, in the elementary schools, especially the pre-K through the four, that was definitely the call of the principal on where we place those.
I didn't see on my list that Taylor Prairie has the hand dryers.
They did not, except in the teachers' restrooms.
Okay, and was there, what was Connie's rationale for that?
Because of the kids.
The noise.
Noise.
Okay,
attention.
So I'm just saying,
yeah.
We've done it, we're in there now. I think we're, as we see, I think we need to watch that research, because
sure.
that, particularly in the elementary schools, that's a factor.
Right.
And then could you also, I was up at the high school and they were complaining about the tennis courts. Is there a problem with that? Do we need an update on that?
Yeah, you need to rip them out and put new ones in. Just in a real quick scenario.
We spent
a lot of money on that. And you're gonna continue to spend a lot of money on it until you do the right thing.
Right.
And you know, I know we talked about it and we kind of, and Paul, I mean, before we did this, if we didn't do this, those tennis courts would not be safe for our athletes. So that's why now what you're doing is you're putting a Band-Aid on something, mm-hmm. and you're going to continue to put a Band-Aid on it to be able to accommodate, you know, the annual use by our student athletes. And that's, I think, something that you talk about bringing things to the forefront. That whole situation up there, from my observation in the year I've been here, and we've talked about it, is that, you know, the way that lays, the base of that, you know, it's just not a good, safe facility.
Okay, so the problem is really the bigger, my impression was that the job hadn't been done adequately.
No.
That was the impression.
Sure.
But that's because the courts are,
they
thought they'd be better.
That's
okay.
Correct.
Okay.
I mean, we're working with something that is pretty much irreparable. And that's it's very unfortunate, because, you know, I think, you know, everyone's expectations here are, is to provide, you know, our students with the best facilities we possibly can. That one is probably the worst for any of our athletic programs.
And I'll just add to that, in fact, Jared and I were involved in a meeting today on that very issue. We actually met with Bob Miller and April Little from the city just to talk about the issue with parking on Cold Spring. And that plan has never been brought to the full board yet as far as potential replacement of those tennis courts, because we have, it's in the city of Madison, we need to work with them. We will have that on the agenda for the board to see that plan this year and talk about moving forward, you know, with that. It is an issue now that we need to deal with.
That's helpful to know that the understand the repair is inadequate because of the state courts, but that the repair was done as expected. That's helpful to know. Thank you.
Yeah.
Appreciate that.
Okay. Yeah.
Any other questions? Thank you, Jeff.
All right, thank you.
Next, Krista with the seclusion and restraint reports.
All right, so we bumped this up. This is a September required report, so we got it in as scheduled this year. But it's very similar to what you've seen in prior years. So just we're required to document and report out incidents of seclusion and restraint from the prior year, disaggregated by students with and without disabilities. And so you kind of have the data in front of you. I did, you know, just for your information, break it out. It's less than half, you know, of the 73 total incidents. 43 were incidents of seclusion and 30 were incidents of physical restraint. And looks pretty similar to prior years. The discussion we've had in the past is sometimes with younger students, it's more typical to see higher numbers of recorded incidents as students are learning new behaviors in school. Not a lot of surprises to me in the data this year, but open to any questions that you might have.
Any questions? Susan?
Based on the policy, we're counting the incidences similarly using similar criteria?
Correct.
Using the policy, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And then do we, because it looks like, and it's probably because they're new in school, it looks like we have more incidences at the elementary level.
Yes.
So does that mean you have to do more training at that level or more staff to assist, or what does
that
mean for you?
I'm glad you mentioned the training, because that is sort of a point of emphasis, is we do have, I think the total, like I said, we have over 106 staff members, and we keep them current in their certification, which other districts don't necessarily. They allow longer time span in between certification and refreshers and things like that. We have been doing, and people have been really good about annual refresher training, so that we can really delve into specific topics related to whether it be young student or specific behaviors or things like that. And every building has a team that's able to do that sort of as needed professional development with staff. So I feel really confident that they have the skills and the tools that they need to respond to behavior. We did have a work group last year that revised our functional behavior assessment and behavior intervention plan process and forms, and we're just starting to roll that out. Actually, our first team meeting tomorrow with the Glacial Drummond Student Services team. So it's an ongoing effort to, you know, stay on top of everything, best practice. But to your point, yes, younger students need more opportunities to learn behavior, and it's not atypical to have more incidents of seclusion and potentially restraint, although I will say again, the predominantly seclusion at the younger grade levels. And they have decreased, you know, even as the kids get older to Cottage Grove or Winnipeg School, we see them decrease as we would expect over time.
Well, we really appreciate your input on the policy and the work on that. That really helps us.
Yep, and we talk about the policy and the legislation at the Nonviolent Crisis Intervention Training every year too, so people are pretty up on best practice. And I will say the data are a reflection of some pretty excellent recording and reporting. So I do feel like the buildings are doing a nice job of making sure that incidents are documented and policy is followed and the information is shared out in a timely manner.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you very
much.
Next is the board reports, starting with policy committee report. Susan?
Okay. Well, we've met a couple times, and we still have some finalization to do. And I'm not actually going to report on these ones that are on the agenda tonight. The main ones that are, there were some NEOLA updates. The one NEOLA series we had approved was the bylaws, and in June, we got, one of the arrangements with NEOLA is that when there are statutory changes, we do get these automatic updates a couple times a year, and we did get some in June. So what you're going to see later tonight are mostly a result of those. So I'll just talk about it when we get to it on the agenda. Otherwise, we're still plodding away, and we're not done yet. That's basically all I have to say.
Okay. Any questions? All right, discussion items, starting with the Innovative Elementary School recommendation and future planning.
Okay.
Dan?
All right, I'm going to ask Director of Instruction Lisa Height to come up and join me. She's going to report out on part of this, to clarify. Okay, I'd like to begin, first of all, to thank the many, many people and the long hours and wonderful work they did this summer, the members of the planning team. We have six members here tonight. Four, including our facilitators and administrators. But going back to the beginning of this project and you know, where are we at tonight, that's what we really want to talk about. I addressed this with the entire staff, and most of the board members had an opportunity to be present when we had our welcome back with staff, and so I won't repeat everything that I said that morning. But the bottom line for me, this started with the work that was done back in 2011, that there was a board-approved planning proposal, you know, regarding a potential middle charter school. The board approved the concept moving forward to submit for a planning grant with DPI. Ultimately, that grant was not approved, and so the project died because of lack of resources. And so I was made aware of that that plan as soon as I came to the district just over 3 years ago. And it's something that's always been the idea that, well, might this be something that we want to consider again in the future if the opportunity arises with resources, space, and so on. We all know how successful our current charter school, high school, has been, MG21. And so the question's always been, might there be some model that would also fit middle school students or even perhaps elementary students, not necessarily the same as MG21, but something alternative that it might meet needs. And so as soon as I learned that we had the parent group that had done some research and had an idea, of course I was immediately interested in learning more about this. Might there be some similarities to the proposal that was, you know, brought forward back in 2011, and so on. And so as previously reported, you know, I recommended that we did, you know, do further study. And summer was the time that we felt we had time to do that. It's very difficult during the school year to free up teacher time and so on. And so what we decided to do is have that representatives from that committee report out the last board meeting. So I didn't chime in much, but they had done so much work, and they still, with the limited time they had, there's so much data and so much information they put together that we have a lot of this documented, but I thought their presentation was excellent. And so you heard the work that they you know, brought forth this summer. And so since that time, you know, I've had an opportunity as well as the rest of our administrative team to really digest the work and talk and really look at, okay, where might this fit in, you know, moving forward. And so I would like to just take a brief moment, even though the board members all have this in front of them and have been able to read it, but I'm not sure if the members of the audience that are here have had an opportunity to read this. Just very short, a couple sentences that kind of summarize the recommendation, but then we get into more detail about what that really means, you know, moving forward. And so with that, the administration recommendation is continued discussion and planning regarding both innovative practices that can serve a range of learners in our current neighborhood schools, as well as continued discussion and planning regarding an elementary school or middle school that offers choice to the community. Our mission is to serve all students in ways that promote high levels of learning at every school in our district. Offering a choice in pedagogical design is not due to any deficiency in our neighborhood schools, but rather a continuation of solid educational programming with a unique focus on project-based learning as the instructional method that guides the students' daily experience. So that sounds pretty broad, and it was meant to be. I mean, it really is the idea that without question, we've always talked about the word innovation in the district well before me, you know, being in the district, and certainly in the time that I've been here as well. The foundation, we heard a little bit spoken about that earlier tonight. They have innovation grants they grant to our teachers. They have for a number of years. We've talked about innovation when we were doing our referendum planning. We didn't talk about a charter school, but we did talk about the idea of continuing, you know, the tradition of innovation and excellence and so on. So it's everywhere that you know, we live and breathe. One of the things that has been eye-opening to us is from the work this summer, as much as we talk about innovation, we realize that we don't always walk the talk, you know, so to speak. That as much as we tell our teachers that yes, we promote innovation, we don't know that we have really allowed that as much potentially as we could. And so that's where the first part of the recommendation comes in, that set aside the charter school for a second, is what about our current schools? Can we do more to promote, to encourage innovation within our current schools more than we're already doing? Who we certainly are, but to make sure that that really is a priority. And so I'd like Lisa to speak a little bit to that about her role as director of instruction of our current schools, where innovation is, and where we might want to look to expand upon the work of that summer committee within our current schools.
Thanks, Dan. As Dan said, one of the takeaways from the summer work, and I think one of the things that certainly is a benefit from the investment that you made in allowing the summer planning to occur, is to see the passion and enthusiasm so many of our teachers have to really continue to push the boundaries of progressive practices in the classroom and how we can make sure that all kids are being served well. And they have wonderful ideas, and sometimes there have been barriers or structures in place that either they didn't know that they could work through, or perhaps they just thought or were told they couldn't work through. So we really want to make sure that we are, as a district, supporting our teachers and nurturing their passion and enthusiasm to do really great things in all of our classrooms. So an earlier speaker this evening talked about current infrastructures and making sure innovation was happening in all of our schools. And without a doubt, that was a thread through our summer conversation. As much as we got excited and talked about what could be in an option of a different school, we simultaneously talked about how we can continue to build those same sort of practices in our current schools. And it is necessary to support our teachers in our buildings and make sure that we're eliminating barriers. So I think a second speaker talked about innovation takes risk, and sometimes we're risk averse in most of our lives. You know, we want to play things safe, and we want to do things that we know will work, and we don't want to fail. And so we really want to make sure that risk-taking isn't seen as potential failure, but yet risk-taking really is different ways to explore what works for kids. And again, as Dan said, talking about how we can promote this amongst our teachers in the buildings is some of our current work. And regardless of what happens with the recommendation to move forward with the charter school and the planning, and if it even would be a charter school or just another option within the district, we know we want to support our teachers and their practices. So complementary to what the foundation does with their innovation grants, we're looking to provide support for our teachers, funding for either their own exploration of certain teaching practices or different kinds of materials, or working with them within a school structure to you know, maybe bend some established structures, work around time limits or different kinds of things that they would see as barriers, and really try to hone their ability to bring forward innovative practices. I can't list what those practices would be because, again, we have so many creative teachers. They have lots of different ideas. But we do know some of the things that they talked about in terms of, like, increasing movement, partnership with different organizations in our community, exploring more in nature, increasing the amount of time that students are in project-based learning environments or doing inquiry or more hands-on learning. All of those things are great things and doable. So we think that with some permission, and we mean really intentional permission to our teachers, that we will see some of those practices really blossom in our schools.
So Kate, can we pause here and see if there's any questions or discussion about the innovation within current schools before we move on?
Okay. Just picking up on the theme of nature, was there any talk yet of making different use or more extensive use of the Cottage Grove School forest?
Mm-hmm. Not specifically, but
that's the one that's just obvious to me, even as we talk about partnerships with other organizations, is we literally have that in our own backyard, mm-hmm. and thinking about that as a 80-acre whatever mm-hmm. plot, I mean, I'm super excited
yeah.
to find out if that's something we could make different use of, better use of.
I really think that, again, I'll use the word permission, when permission is given to teachers to think creatively and to explore different ideas that maybe have been germinating in the back of their mind, but they felt like, oh, no one would say yes to that, or I'm not sure how I would make that work when our 90-minute reading block or 60-minute math block, or, you know, but there, if we are able to collectively sort of put our heads together and work with our teachers, I think we'll see some of those ideas come forward, and it's going to be exciting.
Because I just wondered if there was a barrier there that I didn't know about in terms of safety issue or something that could be addressed. Sometimes teachers know the reason that something isn't
yeah.
being done, but then
mm-hmm.
haven't explored. Maybe we have a resource that
yeah.
can help with that.
I haven't heard any specific conversation about the forest. So I don't know. Yeah.
Susan?
So that actually leads to the question I had when you talked about giving intentional permission, was encouraging teachers to get together and kind of think about how they might reorganize their day sometimes, or 3 to 3 weeks, or maybe it's one day we call a year, or where they
mm-hmm.
would be freed from those required blocks of minutes for literacy or math or whatever it is, and they may be incorporating those in other things. That's kind of what you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So in terms of making funds available to them, are we talking funds available to them to work on their own outside the school day, and or additional materials they might need? Are both
mm-hmm.
of those possibilities, or?
Right.
Okay.
There isn't any talk right now about interrupting their primary duties or
right.
releasing from a school day, but definitely if these are conversations that they may already be having,
right.
You know, with their colleagues, but now they will have a chance to maybe formally present those and propose those. And, you know, that this would be something that the administrative team would review, the requests that come in. We also would have some I'm going to call it pre-innovation and post-innovation expectations, sort of what are you hoping to see as outcomes? What is it that you're trying to improve in the current situation? And really, I mean, in a lot of ways, I guess we could call this sort of like innovation action research that we're supporting with our teachers, and really making sure that, again, they're empowered. These are really well-educated, caring people who want to do great things for kids, and that can look different. And
right.
so we want to make sure they know that we're open to their ideas, and that, you know, we too want to do what's best for our kids.
I think it's great that you guys are kind of forming the bond with Aldo Leopold. So historically, we did that. We tried to do that 5 years ago and build that into the curriculum as a part of the curriculum, and they were actually willing to come teach in the elementary level, use the school forest, which used to be used a lot. I don't know how that's changed, but you know, when you don't have kids and you're not pushing that
mm-hmm.
piece, then things may change. But that was a very involved piece
mm-hmm.
10 years ago. And they actually were keeping this, the keeping it up. But when Camille Zanoni was at Aldo Leopold, she actually was building curriculum for our elementary students
mm-hmm.
that they could then integrate into their curriculum and use at Aldo Leopold.
Mm-hmm.
And again, an example of, do we limit this experience to a few students or to all students? And this is a good place to ask that question.
Mm-hmm.
So when a teacher wrote a grant to the Monona Education Foundation and said, I'd like my kindergarten class to have a field trip to all the Leopold, the foundation, bless their soul, said, this is something all of our kindergartners mm-hmm. should have, and they gave the grant to all the kindergartners. Mm-hmm. So again, incubator, maybe that is what we need to do, but with vision that kind of science education at the elementary level, if it's available to us in our back door, why are we waiting to use it until we study it? I mean, mm-hmm. it's been there. It's been an opportunity for 5 years, I know. At least that long they've been offering us that opportunity. And now they've developed a whole new area for us to work in. So I encourage us to continue mm-hmm. to utilize that science piece and that partnership.
So some of what I think you're referring to gets to core curriculum and what we really lay out in terms of our scope and sequence and expectations for all of our students. We are rolling out our curriculum review and renewal cycle, which I presented, I think, at our last meeting. And again, so far well received. People are excited to have those conversations in an ongoing fashion about what we want our students to know and be able to do, and then how that happens. So in the area of science, for example, this is their renewal year, and so we will have a work team of 4K through 12 science educators really looking at just what you're describing, and what are the experiences our kids are having, and are there any gaps in their experiences, and what do we need to bridge those, and how can we improve that particular strand of learning. And then, you know, as we go through our six-year cycle, we will continually update and bring forward the best possible options we have for our kids.
Dean?
I have a lot of questions here. But does this system require a pupil-teacher ratio less than in our other schools?
Which system, Dean?
Well, we're talking about the innovative school that you're proposing.
Oh, no. This is just a particular internal grant option for some teachers to do some, I'm going to call it little action research or their own exploration of some ideas. This specifically isn't about the whole innovative school.
So the innovation school that you're proposing would have a 25-to-1 ratio?
This isn't about
this. Turn that question back in about 10 minutes. And Lisa's just talking about our existing schools right now.
Okay, go ahead.
Yep.
Like, Dean, I'm confused about what we're talking about right now. So can we dial it back and make it a lot simpler for me?
Sure.
Like, I mean, the way I'm understanding it is, you think we have great teachers and we haven't really fostered their ideas, and now we're ready to foster their ideas. Is that how I'm understanding it?
So part of this proposal is
part of
our recommendation, uh-huh. the district recommendation that you're seeing tonight has to do with what are we going to do to help our teachers who are currently in place before any charter school or second school opens. How do we make sure that their ideas are nurtured so that they can continue to do great things for kids? So this is just a very thin slice of the overall conversation, and we're simply just talking about, as a district, how can we support that kind of work amongst our existing teachers.
So do we have anything in writing on that, or is it just
we're putting together a proposal for how we can ask our teachers to apply for grants.
Uh-huh. And we're going to have money allotted for that.
We'd
love to do everything. The pot runs dry really quick.
Yep.
Right?
So we do have money that we use for our curriculum work. It's a line item every year. We have money. A lot of that is spent during the summer with our teachers working on curriculum. And then some of that is spent during the school year. So that is the money we'll access for this.
Okay. One of the first things that, you know, became clear that the first meeting of the planning in the summer was, you know, a lot of teachers in the room saying, I need to be able to do this, but I can't. Mm-hmm. Or, they whether real or perceived, saw barriers to taking steps forward to innovating mm-hmm. forward. And you and I had that conversation, which mm-hmm. well, why not? And I think that by making this explicit, coming with an explicit plan to help deal with this, I think this is a good step in the right direction, because it's going to make it clear to everybody that we support things. Mm-hmm. And when we'll start the conversations and people will see what the barriers are, and it will give us a framework in which to start working mm-hmm. around those barriers, whether or not they're real or perceived. So I think it's mm-hmm. it's a very good proposal, I think, coming forward. So thank you. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, we're good.
Okay.
Dan.
All right. So let's move on and talk about the school. So in the written summary, mentioned that the recommendation from the planning team was to move forward with the goal of a new school by next fall 2017. Okay. And so I put in there basically three bullet points of what it would take for that to happen, as far as, you know, resources and so on. And three bullet points: continuing working in consulting. And one of the documents you have is titled the Innovation Zone Planning. And you'll see in there, that's a four-page document that basically lays out, here's everything that would have to happen before you're able to open a school. That is very ambitious. It's a lot of work and would require a huge commitment in order to do this. It could be done by next fall, but there's a lot of work that would need to be done. So we would need the additional services of ISN or some other outside agencies to help with the planning. Certainly our staff, release time for the planning and so on, and then the classroom design to further do work on that, and then the needs for that with physical resources, the site, the furniture, and so on. So with that, let me back up. The whole idea of how most charter schools in Wisconsin have been created, if many, is through planning grants and grant money. And that was the case back in 2011, when there was in this district a proposal. It was a proposal to submit for a planning grant. And that's typically how many, many charter schools get started. Right now, there is not planning grant money available from DPI. And so with that lack of resource, that makes it very, very difficult. And so part of my recommendation is, at this point, there are some things we can continue to do internally, okay, that aren't going to require, a lot of resources, while we see if there is perhaps grant money available. We do know that DPI has applied to the federal government for grant money, which then they would put together a process for schools. The last we heard that they're expected to hear back at the end of this month, September 30th. And so that would be one thing that, if that were to become available, I recommend that we would in fact apply for a grant. And again, it's a planning grant. It wouldn't be committing the district to anything other than having resources for that further study and planning. So that would be one thing that we want to continue to study, so that if we have that opportunity, we're ready to go and to be able to submit in a timely manner. The other thing, as far as resources, we need to examine other grant opportunities outside of DPI. And we know that there are, but it's not as easy, but that's something we need to research. In fact, people on our planning team have already done research on that as well. So that would be part of the continued research, is to look at ways of finding grant money, grant resources to help fund the continued study and planning. So with that, I guess I'm not prepared to say tonight that a particular timeline can or can't be met. It's highly unlikely we could, if we had everything pulled together, to meet that timeline for next fall. But if planning money comes available, then we can definitely pick up the process and pick up the speed of that planning. And so more likely would be to continue the study, and if everything came together and we had a proposal that we felt we could support, I think fall of 2018 would be a more likely scenario. But that's something I'd like to continue the study and report back on when we find out more about grant money available and so on, and not tie ourselves down right now and make any assumptions that we can't do anything to keep the process moving. So with that, what does that mean by keep the process moving? At the end, I outlined three areas, and this was a consultation, I appreciate Peter's, you know, feedback as we talked through about trying to outline what are the questions that we need to answer about whether this is feasible, whether we have the resources, whether we have the need, and so on. And some of these we have pretty good answers right now, others need more study. And so if we could kind of go through each one of those piece by piece, and then at the end we'll kind of, you know, bring this all together about what does that really mean, that the next step. So the first piece, of course, is financial analysis and resources. And appreciate Mr. Hibner's comments. He's absolutely right. I mean, we still, despite the passing of referendum, we still have limited resources. All Wisconsin schools do, and we have to be very wise about, you know, how we utilize those resources to make sure they really are, you know, benefiting our students in the best way. So in your report, to get us started, we, Jared put together a financial report to show the financial analysis for MG21. And that would give us real numbers of what we actually do spend on our current charter school. There's certainly more work that we need to be done on differences that this would contain, but if we could go through that just briefly to make sure you understand the resources for MG21. Now, this report was done based upon last year's budget information, actual numbers. We know that the actual number of students varies, and in fact, we're looking at closer to 45 students this year. And so with that, when you look at revenue, we know that all of our revenue, whether it be state aid, revenue limit, authority, open enrollment, is all about number of students. And Jared, you know, put together basically our revenue that we have on the per student basis based on the number of students in the first part of $265,000. And then on the budget information on the expenditures, three full-time teachers, personnel cost for support staff, and then custodial staffing, and then their actual school budget would be the next three pieces. So a total of about $363,000. Now, when you look at that analysis, we say, does it really cost us $363,000 to operate that school? If we didn't have MG21 and those students were in our regular high school, okay, would we have some of those same costs? Would that just be part of the operating budget? And of course it would. It wouldn't be a one-to-one, and you know, we could try to go through the detail, but this at least gives you a starting point of what kind of money we're talking about to operate a separate school. Now, if we had a charter school, and the proposal or the recommendation, I should say, from the planning committee would be a maximum of 100 students. If you had a K-6 or 4K-6 school, would, and you had 100 students, would you be able to transfer teachers to that school to say there's no cost? Well, it depends, okay? If you have 10 first graders from Winnipeg School that would transfer, 10, you know, from Killer Prairie, well, you can't move a half a teacher. You know, so how does that work? And so do you hire a teacher? And where does open enrollment come in? We've never used open enrollment as a way of saying this is a way that we want to have as a steady revenue source as far as how to fund programs. We know this there, but we don't plan on the revenue. It's just we use open enrollment very, I think, cautiously to balance class size. We know we have to take an open enrollment by law if we have space, and the revenue is what it is. So, you know, I wouldn't say that count on open enrollment to say that's how we're going to fund the school. But we know there would be some implication. We also have the space issues. If you are moving students to one school and you backfill with open enrollment existing, we got the issue of what happens when they get the Glacial Drum. So we know that we can't just simply say, well, that's an easy way of funding it. We know that we could have those students in, but we know we have the space issues. So, so with the finance, there's of course a lot more study that needs to be done in this one, you know, document. But at least to give you a baseline of what we're talking about on operating the school, I think this gives you a ballpark. Now the other thing is, do we have those resources? Well, of course, it's all about priorities. You know, where you put those, and that's the I think that's the thing that we need to determine is, okay, is it worthwhile of those resources for what the benefit that we can have of the students? And that's where I think we have a really strong case that was made for that, and the research and the work that was done by the planning team. But there's a lot more work to do as well to make sure that, you know, to flesh out those ideas. So why don't I stop there and have discussion or questions about resources, financial piece.
Jeff?
So if we do 100 kids K through 6, that's 14 a class, which is basically double what we're seeing.
Exactly.
There, at least.
Yeah.
Right.
in fortune class. And that's, and we get more, technically get more, if it's our students instead of open enrollment, right?
Mm-hmm. On the revenue.
Right, on the revenue side.
Yeah, maybe you want to put that.
So, definitely the end result, we get more for our residents because our revenue limit base right now is about 10,600 compared to the 67. The tricky part comes in is that if it is a new residence, we only get a count of a third of them, so it takes 3 years before they really become a full getting that 10,000.
Right.
So when you're looking at attracting new residents to the district, you know, instantly your open enrollment gives you a little bit more up front, but in the long term, your residents.
And technically, if you're doing K-6, you're gonna get new residents.
Yeah.
So you're gonna take a big hit right there. And then we don't know how to break down Cottage Grove, because do you know how many Cottage Grove kids go to MG-21?
I don't.
Because I think transportation would be considerably more.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. And that's something I think Jared does have a line item on the bottom. Yeah.
So currently our MG-21 students don't have a separate bus route. They ride in with the high school kids and then they transfer at the high school and we have one bus that drops off. Obviously, this is an elementary, we would have a separate route, just like we do for New Western Mundo.
Right.
We provide a route that is not attached to any other routes.
Mm-hmm. But it could be, I mean...
We could have more than one bus. We might have two buses.
I don't
know what that is. But right now, that's 40,000, you know, is for that one estimated.
Right.
And that would be trying to pick up in both Cottage Grove and Monona. But
mm-hmm.
we don't know. That's just
right.
based on that. So more
right.
kids increase.
Right.
Okay.
I just wanted to respond to what Jeff said. I have very serious reservations about a different structure, in particular the point you raised about having very small number of students at that grade level, like what you just said, Jeff. But the way that that concern, when I raised it, was answered is that it wouldn't be that small teacher ratio, like the way you just said, K to six, so it would only be whatever it is, 12 or 14 kids at a grade level. It wouldn't be that group of first graders with a teacher, it might be a group of first and second graders together with a teacher. Do you know what I'm saying?
So now you have 28 in the class.
Mm-hmm. I just want to respond to what you said there, because when I raised that particular issue, why would some kids be able to have a first grade class with 14 and other kids that are across our whole district have to have a first grade class with whatever we can do financially? That was a real concern for me, and the response was, well, the kids would still be in a classroom size that would, you know, be big. And then you get back to, well, then what about the premise of the ratio, teacher ratio? So, but I just want to kind of clarify that, because I had that.
To me, that's a different discussion. I was just looking at numbers and costs, just because we're right in front of us without the,
yeah,
you know what I mean?
Yeah. So it's very fair to say a school of 100 would be roughly operating cost double the MG-21, without question. So what is really unclear is the revenue, you know, how that plays out with.
In terms of the revenue, you can't really look at every student has $10,000. I mean, if that was the case, we would have ever had to have talk about closing Maywood. The answer is it, you know, costs less if you can consolidate those resources in one building. And really, the number you need to look at is the cost of pulling this, doing this in a separate school versus if you don't do that school, you know, what's the cost of educating?
Right.
You know, so it's the cost 363 minus the savings.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm minding the difference, rather, not saying, but the difference is if those kids were in high school. For example, you look at MG-21, you know, we wouldn't have the open enrollment or the McFarland students, so that comes off. We would maybe have one or two more teachers in high school. I'm not sure exactly what the number is, but you'd have to look at that, really, to get what the bottom line cost.
No question. So clearly, if we had 100 students in a separate school, and those 100 students came from our existing schools, without question, those existing schools would have a lesser cost. The question is how much.
Well, yeah, not necessarily. It depends on how much you can, you know, that
right.
we have this granularity. I looked at this. You take 10 students out of first grade at Taylor Prairie. If you want to save money by consolidating classrooms, well, then the average class size goes up by 2. If you take one teacher out of that, if you take 10 students out, there are 12 students out, I think, and reduce. Actually, I'm sorry, it was more like 16,
mm-hmm.
but reduce the classes. The only way to do it is to end up putting more kids in.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we have to be very careful about getting
exactly.
those numbers.
Yeah.
And I think that one of the things that we need to do is do a full evaluation of that so that we can have a good number to.
Yeah. So one thing we've talked about would be a next step to find finances is to run some scenarios and say if we have this many students and run a few different ones to have, you know, more accurate information that way. But so it gives us a starting point. I think the bigger question, the only thing that really matters is, okay, whatever these these resources would be, is it the right thing to do to invest those resources, you know, for the students? That's the real question. I think I can speak for everyone to say that there's no question that the resources we're putting into Energy 21 are well worth it, knowing the success that we have with the students. And that's the question we need to answer about this school. Proposed school.
But we had a grant then, we don't have a grant.
Absolutely.
Two grants.
No doubt about it. So, and that definitely plays in. So,
for developing a grant, for developing a proposal and so on moving forward, what we're talking about is just, I mean, right now that cost, that 363, that cost of operating MG21, I think we'd all say it's worth it. We're not getting a grant to subsidize that. We'd all say that's a good value for our money.
Yeah.
Right.
And that's ultimately the question that we're going to have to answer for the proposed school. Is that worth it?
And ultimately, the planning process is not really what's the financial decision. The cost of the planning process is not where we make the financial decision. Where we may make the financial decision is on the ongoing cost to sustain that.
That depends on the cost of the planning process.
It does, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, but I think I'll go back to what I said at the last meeting. I think part of the cost of the planning process, that would be the point about if there is a grant possibility, we certainly should look into it because it is expensive. The planning process does cost. And if we could get a grant to do that, that doesn't guarantee that we'll, you know, the final outcome. But I think it's hard to get the kind of financial analysis we all want, because I too have those concerns. Until there's more planning done, we have it more fleshed out, and until parents really think about, I mean, I think it's easy to answer in an early on survey of, yeah, this all sounds wonderful, and as was said, I mean, these are all things that we want for all of our kids, and we do try to do it in our classrooms. But when push comes to shove to making the decision to take your child from the school that they're used to, and maybe from their best friend or whatever, there are all kinds of factors that go into why parents would make this choice. So I think it becomes hard to calculate that you're going to necessarily get 10 kindergartners from one school and 10 from another. It might be 20 from one school and 2 from another. I mean, we don't know. And that part's very hard to figure out. I think we also have to understand that while I applaud the efforts to look into ways we can do innovation this year in our current schools, I think that's great, and we should support that. I think it's also important to remember that is not the same thing as establishing a separate charter school, which would function this way, because again, we haven't seen the whole schedule fleshed out, but when you have a totally different schedule and you have totally project-based learning, and where you're building skills into a whole and integrated type of curriculum, that requires, as was said earlier tonight, it's hard. That's a different way of teaching. It's hard, and it's very different from what our current people mostly are trained to do. So it requires teachers who select to teach in that kind of environment. They need to be committed to it. Not just everybody can do it or will want to do it. And that's why this is a very different animal, and I don't want us to lose sight of that, because I say favor moving forward cautiously, because I don't want to lose the momentum, and I think if there's a way to do it with sort of minimal cost while we kind of wait and see if this kind of grant type thing is available, that would be helpful. Because ultimately, to do the kind of detail, if you had time to read through that last charter school application, that was a lot, and that was just to get the planning grant. So that was a lot of work, and that's what we're talking about here. So I think I just don't want us to lose sight of that we are talking two different things here, and I still personally would not like to see us dismiss the possibility of the school, because I still think we do have kids whose needs we don't meet as well as we might with a very different learning environment other than what one we can create by just tweaking things in a traditional classroom.
I think that comment brings you to your next.
Thank you. Perfectly.
Okay.
And absolutely. And I agree absolutely with what Susan just stated, that at this point, I don't believe we can dismiss that. Despite the challenges of the resources, we need to continue study. And so the rationale. Okay, clearly the planning team spent a lot of time focused about how is this good for kids. And so we need to continue to clarify that. One of the things that we've talked about, and the planning committee didn't really address it, but I know that they've already done some research. We said we don't, this can't be, I'll use the term elite school for some kids, that it's got to be serving all students. The demographics would be expected to be very similar to the current schools. How do you make sure that happens? What about the parents who don't have, you know, aren't as good at advocating for their children and so on? And that absolutely has to be a key part. And the planning team knows that. We need further research about, and so we can present to the board how would we ensure that that happens. So that would be one key piece about the student needs. So make sure, answer that question crystal clear. Who are the students that might attend this school? So that would be one part of the planning. The parental choice, that's something I think is an important piece. And how important, that's something we need to decide. But I think the idea that parents make decisions and choices for their children, I personally like the idea that parents would have some choice in the type of programming. Now you look at the high school, okay, of course MG21 is one choice, but even within the high school, students, parents have more choice there within as far as the courses they take, and they're, you know, two different students have very different school days depending on what they're doing. And so we're at, you know, the lower elementary, you know, it's not very different at all. So the idea of providing that opportunity for different options is appealing to me, and I think to our team and our teachers. So that's worth exploration for, you know, for that piece as well. It's a challenge given the size of the district that we have. We can't offer a lot of choices. There are much larger districts that have several charter schools. We'll look at our neighbors Madison, okay, you know, Spanish immersion schools, and you know, several others. So that's ideal if you have that opportunity. For us, given our size, I think the best case is that we could have one other choice, you know, and as we talk about, it's going to be a challenge to find those resources. But I think if we can do it, I like that concept of providing that opportunity. We talked about the rationale of it being an innovation, you know, an incubator or a laboratory school. To me, that should be a purpose of the school. If that's a byproduct of it, great. Okay, we talked about with MG21, are there some things that we can take from there to the other schools? It hasn't really happened. I don't think that should be a reason for the school. I think that would be great if we can do that, but I also, based on what, you know, Lisa spoke about, I think we're committed to making sure that with or without a school that we can, you know, continue those things. So I wouldn't say that that is a strong rationale. It's an important point to consider. But I think that it still comes down to the middle bullet point, student needs. Are there needs that we believe we can meet here better, you know, and along with that choice? So I think the work that's been done is tremendous. I think we need to spend more time on, I'll use the word refining it, not the work that they've done as a planning team, but about how we'd be able to present this as far as information, a lot of the details. You know, you heard from the planning team, when they were asked questions, said, well, we've talked about that, but we didn't go further yet because we're not that far in the process. We need to take that next step in the process and start answering those, you know, some of those specific questions. Class size, as you mentioned, okay? We've had some preliminary discussions about what it might look like. We need to flesh that out more. Does it really need to be 14-1, or is it 15, or 16, 17, or does it matter? What are those ranges? You know, we need to spend more time on that. So I'll jump right to the last one because it's all related to this. So as we do the study, we've talked about, okay, the recommendation, full-fledged school 4K through 6. We know that even with a planning grant, there are operation costs that we have to consider. So I think we need further exploration about looking at, is there, if as we answer these questions, are there ways of perhaps on a smaller scale that should be considered? Should we consider trying to focus at, say, a K-2 school to begin with, and then if, you know, potentially adding grades, you know, as an option? Charter versus non-charter, okay, does it have to be a charter school? Well, if there's charter planning money, of course, you know, that would be a rationale. The one big thing that is helpful if it's a charter school is flexibility with teacher licensing. And you know, we haven't explored, we've explored it, or the planning team explored, but to finalize the idea about how do we deliver instruction with things like related arts? Is it integrated? Is art and music and FIAT integrated in with the core teachers, or do we have specialists? You know, those sorts of things we need to talk through about different options. Being a charter school with teacher licensing, that gives you more flexibility in those areas. A lot of the things that have been talked about wouldn't necessarily have to be in a charter school. It could be done in a regular school as well. So that's something I think we need to spend more time on also, particularly if there's not planning grant money. Okay, are there some things then that we can look at a little bit different direction?
Accepting a planning grant, a charter school planning grant money doesn't require us to come up with a planning, a charter school proposal at the end. We could say, oh, we looked at these options as part of the planning process, and we're happy with a non-charter instrumentality or, you know, building. We've decided that there isn't any, you know, these, we don't need these compelling exemptions to get there.
Yep.
So we're not, still not committed under that circumstance.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm very enthusiastic about the teaching methodology, as I testified to last time. I'm also encouraged about the prospect.
Can I interrupt you for a second?
Yes.
I want to make a comment before we start a discussion here, which is, as I view this, we have, to go forward requires a commitment, a significant commitment of resources, and if we really go forward at the end, I mean, a long-term commitment of resources to the district. We as a board and as a district need to come to a decision point on that, you know, to make that commitment, because it's a big one. And the question I have for everyone tonight is, what steps do we need to take to get to a point where we can make that decision on how we want to move forward? And essentially, that's the question I posed to Dan, and that's what I want us to think about tonight, is how do we get to a decision point in the next, we have to do it quickly, in the next few months, I think. What information do we need? What processes do we need? And how do we get there? Okay.
Was there something I said that distracted?
No, I just wanted to say that first. Okay. as a way to okay. start the conversation.
Well, I think that I guess my concern would be is that we probably need, in my judgment, we need to not think of this as an alternative school for a special set of kids. I think the instructional methodology should be able to serve all, if that is the goal. I also think it would be it makes it very difficult to invest money in a school like this and provide it with 12-to-1 ratios, where you're dealing with 25-to-1 outside. So there has to be some justification for its purpose. I would like to take a little bit issue, Dan, with your comment about it shouldn't be an incubator school. Mm-hmm. Because to some extent, I think, I believe the processes and the philosophy, the purposes, the teaching style ought to be able to be integrated insofar as possible into other schools. So could this be a school where master teachers can train other teachers in these methodologies and, you know, or at least at the beginning. So it seems to me that that somehow we have to also address the issue of where do we go from here? Mm-hmm. And part of me says we're going too quick, too fast to have a whole school. On the other hand, I think that we could build that school, and if we find that the teaching methods are useful for all kids, then I think we need to find a way to get all of our staff development. I see it as a staff development kind of thing too. But I think we have to do it partly in light of general cost and how all of our other schools are being financed and supported as well, because we cannot be doing 12-to-1 or 15-to-1 or 18-to-1 when it's 25-to-1. We also have to think, is this going to be serving two communities or one community or both communities? I have a hard time imagining Cottage Grove kids coming out on a high school bus and then being traveled over here. But I think that partly, what is the goal of this school? Is it to be a kind of the mother school for the development of this concept throughout our elementary system, at least? Or is it to be a standalone school with a difference in which we think that parents will have a choice, that perhaps there's a different learning style and so forth there? I don't think that has been clearly addressed. I think we're floating back and forth between these various options. Some of us speak well, some kids learn that way and some kids don't. Others were nodding their head when you were talking about making it good for all kids. And I think it would be good for all kids. And maybe like any teaching method, good for others, but I think that we need to think of this as a benefit for both communities at both times, and we ought to also see that there are not, if it does serve as a kind of an incubator school or a special school, then what is its justification on pupil-teacher ratio and other resources that are not allowed to other schools? And we got to keep in mind that in 4 years we'll probably be back at a referendum, and where does this, will Leopold do this for free? Is there a budget there? All the Leopold seems to collect money. That's what I see. And are there other resources other than all the Leopold? There's the school forest, and there's a whole lot of other locations and things. But I think there's a lot of unanswered questions, and I have a little bit of a feeling I want to move in that direction, but I don't want to go too big too fast.
Susan?
The other thing I'd like to add is kind of specific questions that will be addressed is kind of a fourth one, and that is the transition. So for instance, if you have a conversation with the previous principal at Senate Middle School in terms of their kind of charter school programming and the work that they were doing with the Nuestro Mundo and the students basically coming from the middle school district into Senate Middle School, the transition program for those students. So at sixth grade, let's say this goes through sixth grade, at seventh grade, how did these students then, who have been brought through in a different learning culture, transition into the standard? Again, we've got to think about that. That's got to be a major part. So I'd add that as four to address in the report. The other thing that I think is helpful, and I've encouraged the other board members to do, and some of this I had kind of forgotten, and Dean worked extensively on this as well, but if you go and look at the previous charter school planning grant that was submitted, if you look at D, it says why a charter school is needed to achieve the vision. Isn't that the question we're talking about? And how the school is innovative or unique and different from the schools now currently available to students in the district. Why can't the vision be accomplished by merely adding a program to existing offerings? And if you look at the things they wrote underneath there, again, it's very, very interesting. And you can see how they could make a pretty persuasive argument for this program based on the language that they used. Increased research and development opportunities, flexibility to deviate from the scope and sequence of the grade level curriculum, flexibility to deviate from the time frame. Again, increased community partnership opportunities. We were looking at that 5 to 6 years ago. This has all been explored, so rebuilding it is, and it's all here in the report as having been studied. So again, looking at those questions and making sure we've answered those well is these were things that they were looking for in the application. So if we're going to end up writing an application of DPI, it's going to be very similar. Mm-hmm. And this one wasn't accepted.
It was turned down
for,
I think, reasons beyond its substance.
I would agree.
Right.
I'm under the impression there isn't money anyway, so everything we're talking about is...
Well, there may be, but there may be money.
There may
be.
There is no money. As of right now, there is no money.
That's right.
Right.
So we need to go, knowing Wisconsin the last few years, with the idea that there is no money.
Well, when I jump right into that piece, I think we have two directions we can go. One is we continue answering some of these questions, continue the work with the hope that there is planning grant money. And if there is, that's one direction. Now we have resources to do the full-scale study and get everything answered. And so while we're waiting to find out if there's that money, it's that there's still work that we can do internally. Okay. Then if there's not money available, then we got to reevaluate our options. Okay, now it's a lot bigger challenge. And where do we go from there? And do we talk about smaller scale? I mean, there's a number of different ways. But I think right now, what I'm saying is, let's keep the conversation going until we find out if there's money or not. And be prepared so that if there is grant money, good, we're ready to get that grant proposal together and move forward.
Susan? Stop, Susan.
Sorry, I was just going to say, the other thing I've been really impressed with through the facilitation of Heather and her experience and her group is to look for other opportunities. So the opportunities are not just this particular grant.
Mm-hmm.
There's Dane County grants. There's Aldo Leopold helps you write grants. There's, listen guys, we have Healthy Classroom grants and you've never written for one. Shame on you.
Yeah.
And I'm embarrassed because I'm on the board and we aren't asking for that money. You know, I send it out every year and people go to the, so I'm just saying, if we had a dedicated group who said, okay, let's sit down and write grants. For instance, the city of Monona, and I know Carrie and Peter have been interested in this as well, and we're going to hear some more about that tomorrow night. There's a relationship that's being built with the University of Wisconsin, and maybe there's a way we can integrate some of that programming, some of that staffing that's being integrated into the city evaluations and programs into this type of model in a way that it could be done. There's just, so what's the bottom line on that? We're not done yet.
Yeah. Thank you, Susan. And in fact, one of the members of the planning team just emailed me yesterday with four possible grant opportunities that we should explore.
Yeah.
And so you're right. And that's one of the things that I guess I want to emphasize on how helpful it has been to have community members with that background of expertise to help. We don't have the capacity to do this full scale with the staff that we have. We have staff members that absolutely integral part of this, but of all the work that needs to be done, that partnership is essential and critical to this work. So, but you're right, that we can't just say, well, let's wait and see if there's a DPI grant or not. We have to explore the other opportunities.
Gary?
I saw Susan's hand first.
Susan.
Well, that was going to be my question is what do you need from us? I mean, I know not tonight because we're not voting on anything or making a decision tonight, but at some point, do you just need a commitment, a show of support from us or not a show of support from us to move forward with using some of our current professional development, or just, I guess, what will you be asking us to do later?
So right now, within the next month to month and a half, I feel there's enough work that we can do with myself being involved, with the staff members that we have, that doesn't take any additional resources. I'm not asking for a new contract tonight, with ISN, and that we can come back and answer some of these questions, and then at some point there will be that decision, okay, of financial support, about a commitment, whether moving forward or not. So I guess at this point, I would like even consensus tonight that, keep studying it, don't commit resources yet. And I got to be careful by saying that we do have our general budget for professional development and curriculum work and so on that we will utilize. If we ask teachers to come together and do work on this after school, that's the type of thing we normally have resources for. So, but to not expand our current budget that we already have, and it would be a limited amount. So I don't want to say I want to spend $0, but those would be the type of dollars.
Have we used our $18,000 But that is done already?
Yes, so the commitment with that contract is done. In fact, they've done things pro bono since that time to help with the communication and so on. And I should talk about that a second, the relationship we have with ISN. I'm not sure how clear we were when we talked about that first meeting, the work they did with MG21 in the past and so on. And Heather is here tonight, she can correct me if I misstate this, but ISN, as you know, is a nonprofit, and they partner with a lot of schools. And so certainly some of the revenue they bring in is when they do consulting work. But they also do a lot of work with schools as true partners, where there's not charge. And in fact, ISN paid our district, a couple years ago, at $750 to MG21 as being a lab school, where they could bring other people in and visit and so on. We've actually hosted a conference at our right here in this building by ISN, but it's with partnership with MG21. So they have those partnerships, and so not everything, you know, is necessarily charged. And I appreciate Heather's work that she's helped me these last 2 weeks pull some of this together that's beyond the scope of that original contract, you know, for no charge. And so that's what we're looking at doing right now. And there might be some things that we would look that we might have to, you know, spend some resources, but nothing, you know, major. And so anytime that we'd have something, I would come back to the board again with that.
Do you have a rough idea of the kind of money you're talking about? Is it
sure
$5,000 or $500,000?
In the short term, definitely under $5,000. I mean, I hesitate to throw a number out there. Our professional development budget, and it's hard to say, well, what is it for the district? Because it's in so many different places. There's some in my budget, there's some in Lisa's, there's some in every building. In general, with the superintendent's budget, for overall, and it's coded personal services. You know, that includes attorney's fees and so on, but it's all lumped together. So my budget with all those things is about $50,000 for the year. Hopefully we don't spend it all.
Well, forget about your budget. How much, if we got something from outside, would you be looking for?
If we did the full fledged study, moving.
Yeah, what's your biggest ambition and what's your reasonable ambition?
Okay, the reasonable is a couple $1,000s in the short term. The long range, if we had a planning grant opportunity, we're talking it could be, planning grants are generally in the last go around they were $150,000. Mm-hmm. So you would spend just on the planning itself, you know, up to that amount of money. We were estimating that short of a planning grant, to do everything on that checklist to open a school, I think our estimate was about $50,000. I think I mentioned that number once.
And that's, that, you know, there's no charge for your time working
right
on that. That's how that works, is that you're just taking time from whatever else is going on.
Plus the 18 we've already paid.
Plus 18, yeah.
So that would be included in that
50.
Carrie?
Thank you. I just wanted to make a few comments tonight, in particular in response to the bullet point that you have, and I really appreciate the outline of what the questions are that would need
mm-hmm.
to be addressed. And you have one on there, Dan, about parental choice.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one that I wanted to express my concern about. My intention of getting involved in the school board is explicitly to support our public schools.
Mm-hmm.
And to the extent that a charter school starts to feel like a private school just within the school system, I start to get concerned about what we really have an obligation to provide. And I'm struggling still with the concept that our district is a certain size, that the ideas that we're talking about could easily, in my opinion, scale up where we could do this within a building that we already have, perhaps. And the way that you have it tonight on the what if we started only with grades K to 2, for example, and I'm still thinking about the parental choice thing. If we offered everyone in our district the choice of an innovation school for K to 2, school A, and parents could choose that, or our traditional school, school B, and parents could choose that within our district, could we do this in such a way that didn't require a charter, didn't require a whole other structure? And the thing that I'm wrestling with is when we talk about parental choice, a parent who would say, yes, I like everything about this curriculum and I want my child there, may feel differently if the location of that school happened to be Taylor Prairie School in Cottage Grove as opposed to Nichols School in Monona. And so when we're thinking about what people really say they want when we're talking about parental choice, it's my opinion that sometimes location trumps all kinds of other pedagogy. And it wouldn't be surprising to me if we offered school A and school B, and we said, yes, this is what I want. And we said, oh, good, well, then we've got 300 people who want that. We're going to make it Taylor Prairie. And then people who lived in a different place in Monona might say, well, never mind then. I want to stay at school B. And so it's really more complicated to me than just, let's propose this particular solution. I'm wrestling with the parental choice piece of this. Really seriously wrestling with it.
This is why one of the things I think on the list, and we as a board have raised this with Dan before about proposals that come before us, is a good way to evaluate a proposal is to look at the alternatives too and compare them and you know, see how they're fitting against our needs. And that's why number three is alternative and options, because I think you know they'll help us with financial. There's potential that there's alternatives that are less expensive, you know, less desirable but less expensive. Suggestions that may fit those needs better. But, you know, these needs, parental choice, student needs, innovation laboratory, to me, if we value those three things, if depending on which one of those you value most, you may end up with a different look.
Mm-hmm.
So this is, and this is where I think the looking at alternatives.
Well, and exactly, because if I was looking at those, my personal thing is student needs that would drive this very much more than parental, that our obligation to offer parental choice, because I feel like, well, parents have a lot of choices. They have a choice to go to a private school. They have a choice to do other things. I don't know. I just look at this a little bit differently, where I wouldn't value parental choice is a reason to have a charter school. I'm struggling with that one still. I do think that the needs question is absolutely imperative to answer. You've heard me say it before, but that one is a big one for me.
Well, I think what I understood Dan to say is that, I mean, these are really good questions. We do right now have people coming from Cottage Grove to Nate Meister and Mundo, by the way. So we do have parents making that choice to drive the distance to make a choice of a different pedagogy. And I think that's something we can't know, and that's not for us to determine, really, if we choose to offer this option. I think there are parents who would choose this option. One of the concerns I have, for example, I've mentioned this to Dan, is when we talk about student needs, and currently a lot of our teachers who are interested precisely because they have students right now who they think this would be a good fit for. How do we make sure some of those kids get into this school, or and if it's a charter and it's totally open? But what I understood you to say is there hasn't been no decision that this would be a charter, and this may not be a charter. It may be a school that we could open within our district. So I think those are all great questions, but we don't have the answers to those yet. And that's the point of continuing the conversation, is how I understand it.
Mm-hmm.
So if we encourage you tonight, through, if you said you wanted some sense of consensus tonight on whether we wanted you to continue it or not, that would be the kind of thing I would hope you would investigate more and talk to us more about how, you know, and I don't know how, when MG21 started, my understanding was always that started with similarly teachers recognizing a need for students. And then students apply to that, and it's a little bit different program, but how would we guarantee that, you know, you mentioned reaching out to parents who might not be aware, and you know, I think all parents want what's best for their kids, whether they are aware of what's available and know how to advocate for them, or whether that even occurs to them. Sometimes that does include some outreach. So all those kinds of things are things I'd like to hear more about, of how would we really have parents understand what this would be and how it would be different, whether they might be. So there are a whole lot of questions still to be answered, and that's why I really am in favor of continuing the conversation at that lower cost.
You know,
so we find out about the planning grant.
And from my point of view, the original middle school, that planning grant proposal that we see,
right.
I think that's one of the deficiencies was they identified student needs, but then in their proposal for the school, they didn't show how they were going to, how the proposal was, they weren't going to align the proposal on how they were going to address the needs of those particular students. I thought there was a discrepancy, a deficiency, and a disconnect. And I think that it was my opinion about that. And it's something that I think we need to look at carefully, how we, if we identify needs, how it is we're going to address them at this particular school. Susan?
Dan, when you did the survey about, if given the opportunity, I'm interested in enrolling my children in the proposed school, Did the parents, was it clear in the survey that the proposed location could be Nichols School?
Yes.
I believe we had a statement.
It was, because there was a
question. So I would contend that if given the opportunity, I'm interested in enrolling my children in the proposed school disaggregated by community. Maybe what you need to do is repost the survey so that this board can see those results, because I think it speaks directly to the concern that was just expressed. It says right here, yes, 47.42% from Cottage Grove. So there, I mean, there's clearly an interest.
I would suggest we don't have to answer those particular questions
right,
tonight.
Right, that's getting
I'm saying it appears to me that part of that
And part of what I would part of what I would expect is for
right, through the survey.
Take a good hard look for this people doing this to take a good hard look at the survey, disaggregated by community and so on.
Right.
And
right.
We sort of reach right.
Can I just
space
clarify that?
Yeah.
But it may not work the other way. Cottage Grove residents expressing interest in traveling to the school may not work the same as if the advertised location had been in Cottage Grove and Monona parents were asked about traveling.
Or it would have been higher. You think it might have been higher, yes.
I'm just pointing out that because
the
specific location was attached to the proposal, you can't then maintain that we have flexibility in the location within Monona and Cottage Grove and presume that the results still apply.
Right.
That's all I was trying to say.
I also limited number of people took that survey.
One of the things that's convenient about Nuestro Mundo is that for many people in Cottage Grove, it's on the way to work. And that's one of the things that makes this direction work.
It would be the same thing. Yes.
But it does impact.
Plus, we only have five spots in this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, Jennifer.
Hopefully, briefly, as the work moves forward, I would appreciate more detailed information about how a charter and a non-charter can respond to unshackling our teachers from the stated requirements at the state and federal levels for any and all students, whether they're identified in any particular category, et cetera, et cetera. And I know that's at a super detailed level, but I think that information would be immensely helpful for teachers considering going into the innovative environment, and also for parents. And further figuring out whether that's a good fit for their mm-hmm. child or not. So everything from testing assessments, minutes on reading, numeracy, et cetera, integrated special, I mean, all that language, but in what ways does it free people to construct a day and an experience, whether it's chartered or non-chartered? Mm-hmm. I would appreciate that kind of information. Thank you.
Moving forward, Dan, who's going to participate? Who's going to work
great
on
question.
This? Because, I mean, you have a
job. I do. All right, so moving forward, my intention is to continue the work on it, and unless there was clearly, you know, reaction from the board, no, don't spend any of your time on this. So the first thing is to reconvene the folks that were working this summer. Now, it's hard. I even think about logistics, about trying to get an after-school meeting to get every teacher present. It's going to be difficult. I might have to have a couple, you know, or small groups. But I want to make sure I touch base with everyone who was involved. And then I think put together a smaller group to start working on some of these questions. And I think to determine these questions, the ones that came up tonight, I think we look at that list of everything that would have to be answered before there were a school, prioritize. What are the next things that we need to answer? I need help with that. I mean, we've got feedback here, but the people on the planning team certainly can help me with that work. And that would be the next step over the next month to 6 weeks, is to take the next step and come back then with many of these questions answered, more detail. We'll know more then about the opportunities for grants, I should say, and then where we're going to go from there. So reconvene a smaller group of teachers and parents that were part of the original planning team, with myself involved with those meetings, and as much as staff as we can. You know, Lisa's got a lot on her plate, but certainly she'll be in the loop with that. Chris as well has been working. And our principals are the next group that I want to involve as well. They really haven't been too much. We did have a brief discussion at our admin team last week, and I want to make sure that all the people, you know, as much time as they can, but we can get some more done.
Suddenly a big group again.
It is. Well, representatives from each of those, I should say.
Okay.
Not every, yeah.
All right, Dean?
Could you, the team, put down on one side of one piece of paper where it is you want to go with this and why, that we might have to give to funding sources,
mm-hmm.
to say, would you like to see more from this?
Yeah.
And not, it's not that it's a grant, but it's maybe solicit,
yeah.
type of thing. And it might be the written out elevator talk about where we are, and where we're going, and where current funding will be from.
Yeah, I agree. I think we have a one-page executive summary the team put together this summer. They have pages and pages of other documentation they put together. I think taking the work that's been done to condense that into more and then creating, as you described, to be
where
clear.
We have to go,
yeah.
at the end.
Yeah.
Karen?
I just want to repeat something I've said on other occasions, which is I think it's still a priority to go back to the long-range facilities planning,
mm-hmm.
and how that work in the district would drive the choices that we might have about where the pressure points are in our buildings and where we already know we can anticipate stress in the form of potentially having to add temporary units and those kinds of things. I'm not convinced that we have a short-range plan in place right now that we've all agreed to of how we would deal with an enrollment increase.
Mm-hmm.
I'm super sensitive to that, especially after hearing the Glacial Drumlin numbers. And I feel like the energy going to moving this forward, I can't help but think it's at the expense of, instead of reconvening the Long Range Facilities Planning Committee, or that those should be more in a different sequence, that we need to have our plans about what age kids aren't being served well, or what, you know, what's going on with our,
yeah.
capacity at the schools, that would then make sense about, are we looking at elementary, are we looking at middle school? And so I still have that concern of saying, yep, go forward with this, call over in the next 4 to 6 weeks, work on this, when that long-range facilities planning stuff is just a bigger worry to me. And we got our report on that in 2015.
Yeah.
I mean, I just feel like we've been sitting on that a long time now, and I would rather see us moving forward on that instead of this, or before this, or as part of this.
Yeah, I agree. It's absolutely a higher priority, the facilities, and we will not put that off to do this study. That will also happen.
I mean, only if that meeting was planned before the next meeting of this group would I feel that that was.
The next meeting already is planned.
You know what I mean?
Like,
right? You know?
It's been planned
it's got,
for 3 months.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right?
Susan?
Well, and that's always been a concern, and thank you for bringing that up again, because, yeah, we do have, I think we are going to continue with that committee at least in October. The idea was, after we got the third Friday count, kind of knew more where we stood. I think we do have to talk about whether that space at Nichols could be used to utilize some of this overcrowding at Glacial Drumlin in a short-term range. Now, that would mean bussing kids in, and I know, but I think that's a conversation we have to have. So I agree with you that we do have to talk about that as well. About, but I think we can do it simultaneously. I mean, even though these are both time-consuming things, they aren't going to happen at warp speed. they're things we need to start talking about right away. But I think that is something we have to think about. We have 8 classrooms at Nichols. I keep forgetting, 6 or 8.
Yeah.
So 8 classrooms. That could be
so
fifth grade from Cottage Grove.
Yeah.
I mean, and so you know, and I know if it were looked at as a short-term stopgap, then I know the community wouldn't
it
be.
It would be popular, but
it would not be popular, and it wouldn't certainly be popular for a long-term solution. But it seems to me we have to talk about it as a possible short-term solution. And because maybe the other option is going to be modular units in some of the buildings, moving a couple fifth grade sections out to Cottage Grove School with modular. I mean, there are other, we have to look creatively at that whole thing, but I agree with you, we do have to have those conversations at the same time.
We need to know what it costs
soon, right.
to bring the school's classroom here again.
Right. Well, that certainly would be part of the discussion, yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
And the other thing, as Susan alluded to, I would not even brought this conversation forward if I didn't think Nichols was a viable option. If we didn't have that space, you know, none of this even happens.
Right.
But on the other hand, we haven't confirmed, the board hasn't, that space is available. You're right, we do need to have that discussion and confirm whether it is or isn't part of, you know, other planning needs, and that will happen simultaneously. So that would be part of this plan as well.
Yeah, because there might even be space carved out within one of our other buildings. I mean, within Cottage Grove School or Taylor Prairie School or somewhere, depending on the number of students this was going to be and the playground equipment and all the other parts.
Right.
I mean, there's just, Nichols School wasn't a given to me
mm-hmm.
as the only option.
Yeah.
Do you need anything else to move on?
No.
Are you feeling like you have a sense of what you needed, or?
So, yes. And I think, you know, the discussion's good, and then, you know, we certainly have a list of some priority questions we need to answer.
And we'll, I think it'd be appropriate to bring this back at our next meeting, and we'll have a little discussion about where you are with the planning and the group. And
I would say in 2 weeks, it won't be very far. We don't have a meeting to get ready for. I would say October.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. All right. 4 weeks.
After the long way facilities planning meeting.
Maybe I'll have to report them.
Yeah.
All right. With that, it's 9:15. Do we want to take a break, or should we just move on?
Break.
Take a break.
Break.
All right. Yeah. Take a break. Yeah. 5 minutes, please. Thank you, Lisa.
Yeah, we've got to have that on our calendar.
Yeah.
Item two, under discussion items, revised policies. Who wants to start?
Well, I will.
No.
Well, I guess.
Please.
I'll try. All right, so these are, what you have are the revisions that were recommended by NEOLA, some of which are statutory. So they're very, and I don't know if you prefer me to go through all of them first, and we could maybe approve them all with one motion, or if there's a sense that you want to just approve one.
They're not up for approval tonight, are they?
Oh, they're not. That's right. We don't have to worry about that. You're right. This is first week. Okay, so never mind. So the first one.
I was totally going to go for that, too. Again,
the next one. I know. Yeah, we should all go. Alright, so the first one, the definitions, was simply, we had already made this change actually, NEOLA recommended that we define voting to include that you could have your vote recorded if you could be here either physically or visible by remote access, which we've done before. So we already had that in, but then they added this legal piece. That's the piece in yellow, which only because it's a substantive change, we felt like we needed to get your approval on. We'd already done the rest of it. So where it says remote access during quasi-judicial functions, e.g. termination hearings, expulsions, may be permitted after consultation with legal counsel. That's a sentence that we would like to add. And again, it's due to their statutory recommendation. Any question about that? Or?
Well, does that mean we have to consult with legal counsel every time? Or? Do we just have, I'm not sure I understand.
Have a precedent.
But there probably could be a precedent. I guess we could ask our legal counsel that. I think that's the point, is that if you're going to, because when I asked, back when I asked, just that a WASBE thing, not a formal, like Boardman Clark written opinion or anything, but about the fact that the statute says that you have to be present to vote. So what does that mean? What about electronic voting? And their advice at that time was that you could not vote over the phone because you couldn't see who it was. You had to be visible. And that you couldn't vote, you could not be remotely present in a closed session because there's no guarantee of who else might be in the room with you. If it was in a termination hearing, expulsion, for example, those typically are closed sessions and are quasi-judicial. So, but it wasn't a hard and fast rule, so I think it would just be a matter of getting opinion one time on whether or if the board was more comfortable getting it more than once. But this is exactly the language that they had written in. NEOLA's legal team had written in. So it does leave that open-ended. It would mean we'd find out. And it might even be the preference of the board. I mean, that's the other piece of it, is the board can decide simply, no, we don't want to include that for those kinds of functions, and then you don't even ask the question. So I guess that's the best I can do to answer your question, Peter.
Can I go back and vote on the ones I wasn't able to vote on a year ago?
No, these aren't retroactive.
You can,
and we're still not saying you could
raise.
Do it in closed session. We're saying, but open session now. All right, so the next one, vacancies. Part D and E here was simply adding this language in D, votes should be recorded and preserved, open public inspection. That was a legal recommendation. Secret, and then to state clearly, secret ballots may be used only when board members are electing officers. That's what we've done in the past, and it's kind of our practice. Item E is a new Wisconsin law passed last year, and we were actually supposed to have approved this already, but and it came up because of a situation in Racine where the board was deadlocked 4-4, and there were a lot of major decisions they couldn't make because of that. So the Wisconsin actually passed a law saying that you have to have a method to fill a vacancy within 60 days You have to have something, if the board can't agree on the candidate, that was the point. Because you left, obviously, if one board member leaves, you're left with an even number of board members, and if you really can't decide, then you've got to have some way to break that tie. So their recommendation was by the president, unless we could think of something else, and we couldn't think of anything else, so that's what we went with. So if somebody else has a thought on that.
Neola didn't have any suggestion?
No, their suggestion was by the board president, they had three other blanks you could pick something else if you wanted. If you like pull the name out of a hat, would be another one. I mean, if you had, you know, if you were down to two finalists, you could put their names in a box and pull a name out, that'd be another way. I mean, but there has to be a method. So if somebody has a better idea between now and 2 weeks from now when we do vote, it'd be helpful to send it so we could have a choice maybe, or...
I guess my thought is, if the board, if the president, say me, wanted to act in bad faith here and, you know, delay the selection process procedurally, it wouldn't be hard to do, just
sure.
to get my appointment. So I think that adding language somehow that says that we have to seek and have a vote on or something candidates within a certain period of time, and then if that's not resolved within 60 days, then the board president gets to make the decision. And that, you know, just to make sure that it's clear that that this is really to solve the case where there's a deadlocked board, which I think is the only place that this is just, the only time that this is justified.
It's been
60, but it just says, it basically says, where's the vacancy?
No, it does say from the
kind of bottom,
it's
a procedure.
Yeah, just under the procedure, it runs through the procedure and just...
There's no deadlines in the procedure, is there?
Right, it just says if the incumbent is, that you have to fill it within 60 days, basically. And that's how it's always been. So, I mean, I don't know, I guess we do try to assume positive intent.
I know.
Assume that this would not generally be...
The point is that the board has been through the process and they can't reach a decision.
Right.
The president decides.
Right. From the applicants, I mean, that's it.
Right.
You don't just decide
from
a new person. I mean,
yeah, but the applicants is no,
from the two finalists.
But that was because the legislator wanted the president to pick the person they wanted to be on the board. That was a strictly that case basis.
Right, but
by the
it doesn't matter why. I know it was a weird case, but the law is the law, and it did pass. And
they all got voted out anyway.
Well,
we were supposed to, and then we were supposed to have done this by July, so we didn't need to do it.
If you have any thoughts about how that.
Well, that was my other suggestion, seriously, was put the two names in a box and pull a name. I mean, that was actually my preferred one, but people laughed at me. Well, there should be two finalists by the time you vote.
Different color rocks like they do on Survivor.
Or the person who gets the shirt.
Or make fire. Whoever can make fire faster.
I mean, I don't know of any other way to break a tie other than having either a board member or the clerk decide. Would not be the president, I guess it would be the clerk. But you're going to run into the same situation that you're bringing up regardless. So.
Could it just be the board president can break ties?
Well, you'd vote anyway.
Essentially you would give the board president an extra vote.
Well, that's what you're doing by doing this. That is what you're doing. The president is breaking the tie.
Effectively,
that's what it is.
That's effectively what it is. If you don't like that, again, I didn't like it either, because it leaves then it takes the authority of the board of seven people and it puts in the hands
six
of
people
one
at that point.
Six. But it's kind of like the penalty kick. You know, you can play 14 times and you don't resolve the game. What the law is now saying is, after 10 overtimes, you've got to make a decision here.
There are places that decide higher offices than this by the flip of a coin.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So if that's preferred.
Only when they've gone through a whole process.
Well, right, but we would have gone through a whole process of interviewing people, and if we're really split and we take a number of votes, and it's 3-3, 3-3, 3-3, 3-3, I mean, at some point, if you can't break the tie within 60 days, I don't really have a problem with that, with putting the two names in a box and having Joyce pull one out.
So the one,
something. I mean, I think if people prefer that because of what you're saying, I don't have
personally
a problem.
We can give you both the options and why we don't. Let's just go back.
The one you pull, is that the winner or the loser?
Well, it's we would have to define that. I would say they're the winner. Because I assume they would have dropped out by then.
Is there a motion on the floor?
No, we're not deciding tonight.
This is
the
first read. So we're saying, what do you want us to do? So we'll go back.
So we'll just go back and we'll rewrite it with that as another option. And if you come up with another option, send it. Otherwise, that'll be the other option, is put the two names in a hat and pull it out. on that same policy, but 144.3.
Is there any hat in this room right now?
Box, you can put it in a box.
I have a very nice hat.
I could use my Disney backpack.
It'll say, put it in a box and pull a name out, whatever. Flip a coin, okay. 144.3, conflict of interest. This is another piece that they added in red, part C, and this is just legal language. I believe it's required now, that is required under the Ruzegger-Sandberg and educational government. I should have written that down. Anyway, it's a federal requirement that we add this language.
Yep.
So that's kind of speaks for itself. It's, it involves federal grants. Then we'll go to the next one, which is 160. You'll recall that was the one we discussed at the last meeting, which dealt with whether, well, first of all, the consent agenda, they added, there was some additional language. We sought the advice of Dan Mallon, who's the policy person at WSB, and he had suggested language to clarify what you mean by of routine matters, and so we fleshed that out a little bit more with using his language, and I actually looked at the language from another district, too, to even add something to what he had said. So the first part, the first paragraph of that is simply adding that clarification of what we mean by routine items that would be in a consent agenda. And then it's followed by, we did also on his advice, change the sentence to say, items commonly included in the board consent agendas may include but are not limited to the following. And then listed the kinds of things we include. And we did also on his advice define that contract amendments would be routine amendments to personnel contracts. That's what we're talking about going in the consent agenda. And then the main one that was at issue was item F on version A, whether to include routine object or contracts that require annual approval. So version A includes them. Version B has all the exact same changes except for routine contracts. It would eliminate that, so we would no longer put contracts in the consent agenda under version B. And then to help you make a decision about what you thought about that, I did go back through all of our consent agendas for the past year and listed all the contracts that we've approved. So if you look at those and you know that these are ones we approve every year, do you want them as a separate agenda? And you know, I think the argument was made, or one concern that was raised, was for new board members who don't know what, like, maybe you don't know what the approval of WISE-DASH is. Maybe you always have the option of pulling it from the consent agenda and asking when you're not sure. But if you feel like it's important that all of these be on the regular agenda, then you would want to choose version B that does not include routine contracts. On the other hand, if you think they're pretty self-explanatory and you just read through them, then you might want to include them.
So well, even in your example of the WISE-DASH, if you didn't know what it was, you could ask before the meeting.
Sure, you can.
Right?
You can always ask before the meeting.
I'm getting better at that.
Right. You can always ask before the meeting, or
right.
If you haven't for some reason, you could pull it from the consent agenda and ask them. So that's always an option.
And the one thing on this list that is maybe of more interest to me now than in the past is the gifts and donations are always just considered like this consent agenda.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, thinking back over the past year and some of the flaps that have come up when we accept gifts from the PTO in one building and not the other, for example, that, you know, is there an equity issue? Or, you know, when gifts are just automatically accepted without thought of the impact, that's just an interesting thing that in the future that might be something, as you said, you could pull out of the consent agenda if you wanted
right.
to have more discussion of it. And if it's normal little $25 or $50 gifts, well, of course those should fly through as consent
agenda.
Well,
I think if there are issues, that's also one where administration sees those before they come in. If they
right.
had a concern,
right.
they would raise it.
That's right.
And so I think there are plenty of ways to stop it
Ku Klux Klan.
Beforehand. And I think also when there are big ones, we've had people sometimes pull them to call attention to that. But then I think personally that gets a little iffy because
mm-hmm.
what's big? I mean,
mm-hmm.
somebody gives $100, that's big. You know,
right. Well, that's
so
right.
I mean, for
that's why I'm just
person.
Pausing on the whole idea
so
of being so automatically we just
well,
take gifts and nothing more is said about it.
One thing that did come up too is that we do want to make sure that everybody who is getting a thank you note and is getting a, and particularly because it is a, they can take it off on their taxes, so they should be getting a recognition anyway. But we do, but that's it is recognized in that way.
Do we do that?
I just have some Jared.
Do we have a process for that?
We just got the approved letter back.
Okay.
IRS.
Okay.
Because
so
I don't think people who have donated to the.
Nope. So we've had all those. There, before there was letters that were going up differently.
Right.
And there's
so
specific
will, yeah.
letter wording that needed to go into that letter. So the district did have a issue with the IRS.
So I agree with Carrie.
What was that?
I will often pull the gifts for that reason. And in fact, we approved one that we really weren't aware of the impact of it. Not that we wouldn't have, but we weren't, it slips through. So again, you've got, and the other thing we were doing, we were inconsistently pulling things. So we would pull one retirement because the teacher had been here for 40 years, and then the next retirement, the teacher was here for only 38. We didn't pull that one.
Well, I think we tried very hard not to allow that to happen. I mean, I have no idea if I heard somebody. I mean, I think we've gotten better about that too, because Dan recognizes
all.
We've always retired. Well, we have in the last couple of years. We've always done that. I think that's true. I personally still believe in consent agendas, and this board did say they believed in them, and I think we have to put something in them, and I think all of these things are appropriate to go in them, and when people have an issue with them, they should pull them. I think that, to me, the contract one is something you should think about, and we could decide at the next meeting.
I recommend anything over $10, the clerk goes to their house and thanks them personally. Can you put that in policy?
High level of thanks.
All right.
All right, moving on.
Wait a minute, Carrie.
And the other thing about the contracts is, I think when we sent it back, I don't know who the we was even, but when you went back to look at this, it was also because there was a legal question about whether contracts could be, and so was that also part of your committee, like the policy committee, when you guys were looking at this, did you also then confirm that we can indeed put contracts in the consent agenda?
Oh,
was that like,
oh,
we can only put amendments to contracts
in the consent agenda. You can put whatever you want in. In fact, when I went online to do research, there are some groups who recommend putting routine contracts in. I didn't find a school district that did that, but you can. There are other businesses that do. So it just depends on what you want. And
I'm totally inclined to say yes, as long as you checked it out and
did your previous board report.
Then you can do it. I remember that came up, but I can't remember the resolution to it. So. Okay, great.
So it's just so that's otherwise we wouldn't be giving you the choice.
As long as it's legal, let's just do it.
So okay. So any other questions on these?
On 160s.
Oh, okay.
You didn't do 167.5.
Oh, 167.5. I was thinking it was 167. Oh,
yeah. It's the same document.
Yeah, I'm going to have to find it here, but I didn't put that separately. 167.5. Oh, use of electronic mail. Oh, right. Oh, yeah, and this was another significant one. I forgot to print this one. Use of electronic mail. The recommendation from NEOLA was that we, as usual, be very cautious about using email, and that we are warned, as our staff members, that there should be no expectation of privacy. That's always been in our policy. And cautioned also that if you get an email from someone on your personal email that relates to school board business, you should immediately forward it to yourself on your school email so that it is archived, because it is your obligation to produce that if there's later a public records request about it. They are all subject to public records requests. The other recommendation they had was that, and we've talked about this a lot before, was that responses to questions posed by members of the public, administrators or school staff, if you respond to those in an email, you should be sending a concurrent copy of your response to the superintendent. And we agreed with that. I know I have encouraged people to do that always, because I think when issues come up among staff members, and I think it's very easy to copy the email without the staff member's name on it, if that's a concern. But I think it's important that the superintendent needs to know what concerns are being raised, and so that was always my practice when I was board president. Anytime, and it still is, anytime I get a question from a teacher or I get a phone call and they don't like something or they're concerned about something, I pick up the phone and call Dan and say, I just want you to know I met with a couple of teachers and here's what they are concerned about. Or if I get an email, a copy goes to Dan, and a copy of my response goes to him, so that he is informed of what concerns are out there. Otherwise, he can't deal with them. So we felt this should be put into policy, since it's a practice that we've encouraged, and some of us at least have followed it. I don't know that we all have, but we felt like we should. So that's also being proposed in 167.5. Anybody have any questions about that?
The problem with that is then the whole board doesn't know. If there's concerns, one person's hearing all these concerns, the rest of us don't know. And then I think that causes problems, and I think we ran into problems a couple years ago.
Well, I think it's, yeah, I think that if it's the kind of thing that the whole board should know about, it would be easy enough for the superintendent to inform the whole board. And if it's a closed session matter, in a closed session, or in a board report, or just in an email, it doesn't have to be a board report, to say, here's a concern that we've heard about, and here's how we're answering it. I mean, I think that's, because that also happens anyway. I mean, you guys are parents, so you're in the schools, so you may have people approach you more often than, for example, I do. I don't have that many people approach me these days. I did, when I was board president, more often. So that already happens, and I think we have run into situations where people are out having private, separate individual board members conversing with teachers or parents about issues, and then not bringing it back to Dan, and then he again can't address it if he doesn't know about it. And they aren't always cases where we do all have to know, but maybe if it is, then I would trust the board member to say to Dan, I'd like you to share this concern with the full board. I mean, I think those are kinds of things that could be easily handled as long as the communication takes place in the first place. I mean, I think that was the idea, was that this would encourage people to be more transparent about what they're saying in response to people, as well as about the concerns that are coming in. So, Dean?
If a teacher contacted you, say, on a concern like that, mm-hmm. and asking your advice, and you gave them the advice back, you would inform Dan. But would you tell the teacher that anything we talk about, what I'm going to do with this conversation?
Oh yeah, I always did. I always told the teacher I'm going to share this with Dan because he needs to know. I didn't always give him the names, depending on what it was. I know there were some ones back when we were still doing contracts, and there were teachers concerned about the teachers in the middle that we just tried to address with our compensation plan who are very concerned about it. And I had a few meetings with people, and I did immediately talk to Dan and say, here's a concern, or other kinds of issues. So I always told them I was going to share the concern because I think that's important. Usually the most appropriate response for a board member usually is to direct them to a staff member, like whether it's Lisa or Krista, because most of the concerns can't be addressed by us. They have to be addressed by staff anyway. So it's more a matter of sometimes channeling them to the right person or saying, would you mind if I have so-and-so call you? I've done that before too, where I've said, but I just think it's important that the superintendent be aware if there are concerns out there. And
now, if XYZ called me and says, I have something I want to talk to you about, would it be my obligation to say anything you say to me will be communicated to Dan, or did you communicate the substance or the fact that you've talked to so-and-so about a particular problem without quoting them?
Well, first of all, this is just talking about emails. This isn't talking
email.
About
okay.
conversations.
Email.
But if I had a conversation, because I do remember having a specific conversation, it was just about salary. It might have been about something else, about they didn't like the way something was being handled in the district. It was something, and I said, just so you know, I am going to share this concern with Dan. I'm not going to mention your names, but I am going to share the concern. I got home, picked up a phone call, and said, I just met with two teachers, and here's what they're concerned about. Because he can't fix stuff if he doesn't know. And that was my feeling at the time. So I think it's easy enough to do that. And that you can do on a case-by-case basis. Frequently, when people come up to you, if they have a complaint about busing, for example, you get those because you're walking in your community, and you always tell them, call Jared or call whoever, call Nelson's first call.
Sorry, Jared.
Because that's really what you have to do in most of these cases, or the concern that was raised about the curriculum thing, if there's something being taught differently in Glacial Drumlin than it's being taught at Winnequa.
Call Lisa,
talk to her about it, because that's not something we handle at our level. I mean, those are all staff administrative issues. So it is important that we not try to answer those things a lot of times, because frequently we don't know the answers. So. But I think we have to be careful about that too, because I think there's a natural tendency when people come up to you and they're upset about something to try to solve their problem, and usually we can't, because it's usually not our deal. So I just think that when we talk about transparency with regard to our decisions to the public, I think we also owe it to our staff to be transparent about what we hear and make sure they're aware of those kinds of issues. I guess that's my point. And I think this was specifically related to email, and that's an easy way to do it, to send a concurrent copy, and if you want to take the person's name off, take the name off.
Jared?
That was going to be my question. Actually, the technical interpretation that I have of this language is with the concurrent copy means at the time you're responding, you're CCing the person and they're mm-hmm. being included, and you couldn't redact the person's name you're sending it to if you're copying the person on the message being sent to them, right? So I'm not sure this is exactly what you mean is with the CC.
Yeah,
because
there
would be no way to prevent
that's
them knowing who was being sent to. I think
what
you're really saying is forward a copy to the superintendent to say, I just sent this to this person, wanted you to see the exchange. Then you could redact the name of the individual if you felt like it was a... the person came to you and you said, well, I'm going to share this as an issue, but protect your identity. That hasn't come up for
What we could do is say with a concurrent copy of the content of the response sent to the superintendent, that might...
But concurrent means at the same time that you're sending it.
Well, right.
So
well,
there's
right.
just something problematic
well,
about
yeah,
that.
Well, they do want you to do it right away. That was their point. But we could think about that more because I understand what you're saying.
Asynchronous copy. it's either at the same, right, it's either CC at the same
we,
time
we
it's sent.
We can say a concurrent
later.
Copy or immediately, or following immediately. So
right.
I think we can play with the language.
I was just asking
that's
what you really intended, because then you wouldn't be able to redact the name.
No, that's a valid point, I think, so.
You know, I think that this is generally a good practice to include the conversation, the superintendent in the conversation, particularly when it's in a service issue, when it's a parent talking about busing or
right.
something like that. I have a little bit of difficulty making a requirement at all times, particularly when it comes to people, just member general and the members of the public, to which Dan has no personal responsibility, that we as elected officials serve. And
actually, he does have a personal responsibility.
Well, it's a different level of responsibility.
You have to give me an example, I guess.
But I do think that, I would prefer language that says that this is what our preferred thing is, but a board member has a discretion, if they so choose, not to include the superintendent in the conversation. Terry?
Because the example that came to my mind immediately is, I always love these examples, the person who literally stopped me in Metro Market to complain that on the first few days of school, her child at Taylor Prairie was being given too much candy by the classroom teacher, right? Okay. So that's not the kind of thing I'm going to take to Dan.
Right,
I mean, it's
right.
going to be
yeah.
like, well,
well again, this
discretion.
Is, again,
I mean,
Tanya Reed,
right.
we're saying.
But again, this is email. So you're right. Use your judgment.
But I get emails
kind
of that nature,
right.
right, or instant messages or Facebook
yeah.
posts or whatever you want to say. But there's certain things that rise to the level of, I'm going to share this with you as a one-off comment that someone made offhandedly. That's not the same as, I've heard this from a few people, and I think
right.
this is becoming a concern.
What about the situation where somebody says, I want to have this discussion with you, and I don't really want it to go to anybody else right now.
That was Dean's point earlier about confidentiality.
Do we respect that wish? Because we would have to violate the policy to respect that wish.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And it's never happened, and I would encourage us.
This is just email.
I understand
okay.
it's just email, but most of my communication with people, constituents,
mm-hmm.
is email.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think you can say, just so you know, if I feel, I will be sharing the content of what we talk about with the superintendent. I won't be sharing your name, won't be sharing your school, won't be sharing whatever teacher
but
you're talking about.
If there's a problem,
well,
you're, there's no way that he's not going to know who it is. So.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't think that's true.
I think,
often. Often the nature of the problem may make it identifiable to the person.
Well, here's the problem. So the person brings a problem to you, what are you going to do about it?
Well,
you can't kind of do anything about it.
Well,
it depends.
It depends. I might be able to allay their concerns simply by what, what I know. Maybe, in general, I'm not going to go fix the busing thing. That's not true.
Right.
But somebody might come to me and with a concern about something because they don't understand how something works
right.
or something like that, and they want to have a conversation.
Well, and then I would say if it's as simple as that and you're having a conversation, you don't need to forward it.
Well, what?
If it's
right.
an email, in general, I think it's better to err on the side of sharing it. Because that also speaks to communication that comes from the district office. Because if there are people out there wondering about how a certain thing happens,
there's no question that it's good practice. We're not arguing that it's good
right.
practice. What I'm saying is that there may be, I can envision situations where there are exceptions, and I'm not sure that I want a policy that doesn't reflect that there may be exceptions to that. That's what I'm saying. Jeff, and to be honest, I can't come up with an exception right now.
Right,
but,
okay.
But I think that the board members should have the discretion to serve the public as they
right.
see fit, best see fit. It's somehow that has got to be in the policy.
Right. As board members, we're responsible to the public, and when you write policy, you have to take names out of it. Because this isn't me emailing Dan, it's
whoever's going to sit here 5 years from now emailing whoever's going to sit there from 5 years ago.
Sure.
And I mean, have you always went to the superintendent, no
yes,
matter
I
who
did.
The superintendent was?
Yes, I did. I was our previous superintendent as well. Same thing.
But I mean, what if somebody comes to me and says, I had this major problem on the bus, and I called Jared, and Jared completely flubs it, and or whoever's sitting in Jared, and the person doesn't come back to me, but then tells all their friends how I didn't care about their problem, right? I mean, I think there's certain things that if you're going to go to somebody, the whole board should be in on it to know that we're handling everything correctly. Personally, I don't think that I agree with Peter that we can't be forced to do something like that out of email communication. I just think that that's got to be our discretion on what we do and who we talk to.
Well, first of all, the reality is we can put this in policy, and if you ignore it, who's ever going to know? I mean, I think we should put it in as a good faith thing. And we can play with the wording if you're really worried about it and want us to put in general responses should be, so there's a kind of a little bit of an out. But I think if we, I guess the question is, do we generally agree that most communications should be shared? And if I can't think of one that shouldn't be, frankly, but maybe
well,
there'd be one. And I just think the point is, it's never private, because if I do an email search, if I get wind of that I think you're communicating back and forth to somebody, I'm going to ask, do a public records request, I'm going to get all your emails anyway.
Right.
So wouldn't it be better if he was informed in the beginning? I don't know.
I agree with you. It's great practice, but I don't think it's a policy.
We're creating all kinds of odd
policy
situations.
Yeah.
Karen?
That was exactly what I was going to say. Was, I mean, email is its own category because it's a record.
Yeah.
Right.
So there's a little bit of weirdness to the fact that email in some people's use has strayed from business correspondence to casual one-liners with not even Dear Carrie or who it's from. It's just,
yeah.
And like a text message, except it looks like an email. And so this is a weird category, because everything we were just talking about was more like casual remarks or confidential conversations, but those things aren't really protected in email.
They're not, right.
Anyway.
Because
I was going to say
yeah.
just now in response, well, you could add a phrase like, unless confidentiality was requested, at which point the whole thing becomes moot, because if someone emails you, please keep this confidential, your response has to be, you've emailed me at my school board email address. There's
yeah,
no such
there
thing
no
as
problem.
A confidential at this address.
Right.
And so that's a little bit kind of odd in this situation. This seems to me more about if Dan, or any superintendent, to your point, I mean, it could be anyone in that role, would find it helpful to get what I would think of as a heads up.
Right.
That this is happening.
Right.
So that you don't find out about it by the open records request as published, whatever, because you could eventually find this out. So if you were finding that it won't increase your email burden by
right.
sevenfold, I mean, I'm not having that many of these, that it could be more than one a month that I would forward to you, if any.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But just my thought of reading this literally, it talks about responses to questions
right.
posed. I'm assuming this means something of board or public interest.
Right. Right.
If I get an email from a parent complaining about a teacher or a principal, I am not replying by email. I'm picking up the phone.
Right.
You know, and
yeah,
I assume
right.
most of you would probably do
right.
the same, knowing that any reply I have is a public record now. And
right.
Besides the fact it's difficult to address complaints sometimes
right.
by email.
Yeah.
So what if a teacher
right.
sends you an email and says, we need to talk, I have a problem?
That's not really an email, that's like a text message.
Well, it's an
yeah,
email.
You don't have to necessarily
but I mean,
share
I mean,
that. Yeah, that's,
yeah.
That's not a response
point,
to a
that's
question.
That's not a response to a question.
Right.
A
right.
question, it, a response
so
to a question.
Different.
Yeah, I think it's important to read the whole thing. And it does say it's just email, and it says responses to questions posed by members of the public, administrators, or school
right.
staff. So if you're yeah, responding
right.
to a question,
yeah, because
then
the time is not really
times
a problem.
Talk to somebody tomorrow. I mean, really.
Can you just forward the NEOLA recommendation on this? I can see their rationale.
Yeah, there should be a little.
Yeah, there is a little blurb, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, we could send that out.
What you just said is helpful too, Susan, because really
yeah.
that's why a CC is totally fine. You just respond,
right.
copy Dan.
Right.
Move
I mean,
out
that's
your
usually easier, and usually it's on something that doesn't matter.
Yeah.
I suggest we've discussed all the possible nuances on this.
Right.
I think we have.
We have.
Anything that would be like that would come
up. Next time, when this was the first read, next time they said, I'll just go automatic. Yes.
Annual meeting agenda. Go.
Okay, so this, there is, this is a point of information. There is no change. This is the traditional agenda that we've had. Things that we're legally required to do every year. We'll fill in the blanks on item H with the exact amounts as we get closer. On that, and so I guess are there any, I'm not aware of there is no other business that we have at this point to get forth to the public, besides what we've done traditionally. So I just want you aware that we will, Jared and I will work together, you know, Joyce on this, get our legal notice out here the next week, two.
Friday.
So.
Okay. All right, action items, discussion of possible approval of teacher compensation plan revisions.
Okay.
Which were presented last week.
Yeah, so last meeting, Dean went through, you know, some of the rationale and the changes. So what we have, you had last time a marked up version of saying it was partially revised and here are things we need to clean up. And so we made some additional cleanup. So you have two documents on your attachments. One is still has some things highlighted to show here, you know, the key things that were changed and then the actual clean document. So I guess I won't repeat everything we talked about last meeting, but if there are additional questions, we can clarify. So nothing substantive was changed, it was just meant to clarify.
I'm just gonna move approval of the revised teacher compensation plan as presented.
Second.
So moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Any discussion? Susan?
Dan, have you received any negative feedback at all about the plan?
I have. The question about the amount of compensation for the level four, because in the original plan we said it was recommended approximately 5% increase, and then we decided to go with a flat dollar amount of $2,000 for everyone. I explained to the teacher that I had the conversation that because we had other areas that we wanted to address this year, we will revisit that. And again, next year, whether we stay with that or do move to a percentage, but so that I did get a reaction that way. And I think I had one individual meeting with the teacher, and I think I heard through her mouth that that was a concern, that there was an expectation that that amount might be a little bit higher for that. So with that, as far as the communication, I think I've shared that we've reviewed this stuff with the MGA leadership. And then we do plan on having informational meetings and listening sessions for the next couple of weeks. So we'll get those scheduled where we can present this and to talk about the rationale for what we did this past summer with and with the changes, as well as to listen about more input. So that was a long answer to a simple question, but.
No, but I think your answer, as I understand it, is that effectively, what I'm trying to find out, because nobody's here tonight, is that there's general support for this from the teachers.
Mm-hmm. That I'm confident saying yes. As far as the language changes about the application process for level four, those changes, yes, we had unanimous, I believe, of the work group of teachers and administrators this summer.
And then, so there's a feeling that there's support for this. And then the other thing you just said, which I thought was very helpful, was approval tonight is for this, with the idea that there's a continuing ongoing process for improvement.
Yeah, absolutely. I guess I look at it that we talk about a transition plan.
I want that to be really
we're kind of in year two of transition, and I see a year three yet of transition. Yeah.
And will you also let us know when you have those listening sessions?
Yes.
So we could come just hear what they're concerned.
Yeah.
That would be very helpful. Yeah. Understanding that it's kind of like the health plan. We're still listening to you.
So we are going to schedule them in all five buildings.
Okay.
To try to get to as many teachers as possible.
Okay.
It's Baroon Dean. Sorry.
I'd just like to reinforce what Dan said, that working on the teacher compensation plan, as well as the meet and confer and collective bargaining, those have all had concurrence all along the way.
Okay. We move and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Two, discussion of possible approval of resolution authorizing temporary borrowing.
All right, this is our annual cash flow borrowing. We did this exact same program last year, same amount, $5 million. And I had listed out the reason why we participate in the cash flow is obviously the level of our fund balance, but then also when we receive money from the state, such as open enrollment students don't get paid for until the end of June. So this is the resolution. We will be working with PMA like we normally do. And just the notes change from your previous years. This has to be done in a roll call vote.
Susan?
I move approval of a resolution authorizing temporary borrowing in an amount not to exceed $5 million, issuance of taxable tax and revenue anticipation promissory notes, and participation in the PMA levy and aid anticipation notes program.
Dean?
I'll second that.
So moved and second. Discussion? Roll call vote, starting with Dean.
Aye.
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 Motion carries.
Thank you.
Future agenda items.
Oh my gosh, we're almost at the end of the agenda.
I thought we'd come back tomorrow night.
Jennifer.
I believe the items I'm going to speak to have been either directly or indirectly pointed to, and so I simply wanted to reiterate. So I'm interested in when we're going to return to conversation about the potential of the Monona properties and the tennis court situation, that whether that's status or progress, I'd be interested in that. And then the other piece that I'd like to have on a future agenda brings us back to our long-range planning and the potential for land purchase in Cottage Grove for future use. So those two things are percolating, and I'd like them to resurface. Thank you.
Anything else? Future meetings. Tomorrow we're having a workshop where we are going to be discussing personnel management issues.
And just a note, I apologize it's late, but this afternoon we did get some items posted on board docs for tomorrow night. That if you have a chance to review in advance, if not, we'll have time to go through them.
Yeah. So.
Sorry.
No.
That's all right.
I have a bad day at home.
Then there's a bunch of meetings coming up. You see the list, I won't read through them. Our next board meeting is the 28th, and then there's October 5th is the annual meeting.
If, I think maybe you said it already, just confirm that we're at 7 o'clock tomorrow. Initially, we talked about 6 o'clock,
right.
But there's another. Yeah.
That's part of the meetings, right?
Is there,
city meeting at 5:30.
Is there anything out of the ordinary for the annual meeting that you anticipate?
No. I think the only difference would be from what we normally report is addressing what we talked about earlier, specific to the referendum. We'll be including that report.
All right.
Motion to adjourn at 10:04.
It's already 10:05.
Dude, so I had it ready.
It's only 10 o'clock.
No, it's not midnight yet?
All in favor?
Aye.
You're getting soft.
Motion carries.
And again, I will be here.